maybe a little one.
Good morning, and the time is now 9 a.m. on a Friday. It's 8 p.m. on a Friday. It's 8 p.m. on a Thursday. Is it Thursday night? Where are fuck it, whatever. Here's a bunch of hair and some words.
Good Narbon, and welcome to the Pot Topic Podcast. I'm your host, someone with me. I have other hosts. I have Tobias. Woo! I have Hal.
I am, in fact, Rear Admiral Homunculus Sherry Flask. I'm the Vice President of the Committee for the Preservation of Vintage Buckfast in Bengalese Pepper Mines. And I recently sold my eyes to the Royal National Institute for the Blind purely out of spite.
Oh, that's our howl. We've missed him. And we have Taz. And Johnny.
Hello.
On this podcast, we have several topic pots. We pull them out at random, speak for 2 hours whilst drinking.
We're going to pull out the topic pots.
Topic pots.
Pull Johnny, them out. Do you want to do it?
Yeah, sure. Where am I pulling from?
There you are.
Oh, I'm doing that bit.
Yeah, yeah, the whiskey.
You're drinking whiskey.
Yeah.
Did
you already take the...
Yeah, just to the... Okay. Oh, good, I can talk.
You didn't take the...
The reasons being will become clear quite shortly.
Are you sure you took this off?
Yeah. Just fucking open it, mate.
You didn't actually take it off, though.
Yes, I did. Look,
tell me I'm going mad.
That was the sound of the foil hitting the table.
Tell me I'm not going mad, okay, if you say so. Tell me I'm not going mad.
All right.
This is good audio.
Oh, fucking hell.
Two hairy buggers try and open a bottle of whiskey. Live for your entertainment.
I believe I'm not going mad, just for the record.
No,
I think it's this important moment where I say we've launched our Patreon.
If you too can help fund more muscles. Do you?
Oh, hang on.
This was not a matter of muscles.
There's a second
engineering.
Foil.
Check out our YouTube channel where you can see us doing resistance training on bottles of whiskey.
Come on. Fucking missed that, didn't you?
No, there was more foil. We got that.
Yeah.
He said foiled again.
Come on.
Patreon.
There you are. Do you want to try it again?
Right, here we are. On account of anti-climax.
That was a pretty tasty little pop.
Oh.
Sorry about the static here.
Lovely, right?
Cool. Yeah, it's the Talanas storm. Not the dark storm, which we had before, but just the storm. And, we're trying to get to... Oh, yeah, first off, do you want to do, like, when we're recording and when we're releasing and all that? I have no fucking idea. you may have guessed from my intro, things are a little upside down at the moment.
Well, we are recording on the 7th of December 2017, and it's due for release in 3 fucking days. Shit.
Is this technically therefore the closest we're going to get to the Christmas edition, or is there going to be one?
Nah, we'll do a Christmas edition.
Right. Actually, no, yeah, there would be one just before, wouldn't there?
Yeah.
Is that Christmas Eve? It's fucking Christmas Eve.
Fuck yes, let's do a Christmas Eve one.
Bugger.
I'll... Fuck yes!
Can we do the Halloween special on Christmas Eve? We never did this year.
Yes!
We're going to be a mess.
Yes! The Krampus special!
Oh, gave her the Krampus special.
Everyone been up
to? I'll just get shit out of the way first.
You've been boring for the last 3 weeks.
So, yes, I have been to New Zealand and back. And I'm not going to talk about that much here because Heather and I did some recording while we're out there. And I am going to wrestle that into some sort of listenable thing over the coming.
Good luck. I've been trying that for 74 issues, mate.
we only talk about New Zealand there. After New Zealand, we did 4 nights in Fiji, which... not really my thing. Only it was almost my thing because there were storms, which I liked. But we turned up and Heather got upset because the sky wasn't the right colour.
What?
Which, yeah, I don't know. It took a while getting over.
Did you send ahead like a message or something?
Specifically ordered puce.
Well, I mean, I put it up on Facebook, didn't I? Like somebody obviously got my memo about paradise needing more grey. Hashtag Argent superiority.
Hashtag the most British thing you've ever said.
But, yeah, no, so...
I'm sorry, being in Spain, looking at a palm tree and going, well, it's not an oak, is it? that beats it, I think.
Yeah, that's how
Is that something I literally said?
Yeah.
Was that in Spain?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. I bet that really, really pleased your parents. So, yeah, after 2 weeks of high adventure in the land of fucking Middle Earth, Helen and I got to a dank, wet Fiji and roundly didn't really get round to doing much other than being quite drunk and eaten alive by sandflies. I will say this, the resort we went to has a little poster and their marketing slogan is, it's not perfect, it's paradise. Which, for me, is fucking perfect. Because any time Heather complained about the weather and was scratching away at her bites, I'd say, oh, we should have gone snorkeling, but we couldn't do it because they fucked it up. I would just go, paradise. but yeah, that was a nice way to round it off. Like the Fijian people are fucking lovely. They're so friendly. They're so smiley. Anywhere you walk, it's all bula, which is, you know, their generic welcome and hello.
Are you sure?
Yeah, well, fuck off, white boy.
They insist on you saying it back to them. So I would assume so. Also, it turns out Fiji is one of the few places where the British Empire did some colonial population buggery, and it didn't fuck the place up. So like we had sugarcane fields, or the Empire had sugarcane fields there, and they took a load of Hindus and which is the Indian population over to work it, and that's exactly the sort of thing we've done in the past that has caused for example, the nuclear tensions between India and Pakistan. But in Fiji, everyone's just like, fuck it, no, this is all right. Like, half the people are Indian, half the people are Fijian. And they're like, yeah, no, cool, we'll get on.
Well, you know, it's not perfect.
But it is paradise. I am home, and the whole thing with jet lag. So we travelled jet lag direction on the way to New Zealand, and it wasn't much of a problem.
Jet lag direction?
Yeah, so travelling east is harder than travelling west.
Okay.
And that wasn't too much of a problem. It just means you get tired by the time night's fallen, which is fine. It was manageable. You go to sleep, you get up, you carry on as normal. I figured I'd fucking knocked out of the park when I came home. I was in bed by 9, and I slept right through to midday the next day. That was like fucking 13 hours straight sleep, which I never do. But what got up, I thought, fucking bang, out the gate, nailed it. And then I was ill the next day, which meant lots of sleeping in the day. And yesterday, I accidentally slept up until the point I had to be in work. And today, I woke up at 4:30. So I reset the jet lag and slowly gone backwards into sort of almost Fiji time.
Dare I say it, this sounds a bit like jet lag.
Well, yeah.
You retrofitted your jet lag.
I sorted it out and then fucked it up again. I've kind of basically entered into this Benny Hill sketch between me and my sleep patterns. which is really annoying because I had shit to do today. I was going to get to work on that interstitial podcast for New Zealand and book a sorely needed deep tissue massage. But, oh well, I guess I'm just going to have to drink this whiskey and eat a kilogram of lasagna when we're done.
I just now can't get out of my head an image of this narcoleptic Benny Hill. It would just make his program so much more interesting. He's chasing after these deer dollies and they're falling asleep on them. Oh god, I'd
be the shortest Benny Hill theme ever. Da, 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 da. Oh, I caught him.
Yeah. every time he falls over, it just goes into quarter time and the music's done by a tuba.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've never quite got the whole shebang with jet lag, and I know that can be sound horrendously patronising, and I'm sure it does. But I've never.
How you never?
Yeah, me? No, I've never experienced it.
How many long haul flights have you done?
Well, I went over to America once, twice. Sorry, no, twice.
You also went. Where was the sand dunes?
Dubai.
Okay, so you went to Dubai. That's quite far away.
But I've never. I don't know. Is it possible for one to be impervious to jet lag. I mean, is that
so? What I'll say is the effect.
You,
that...
yes, maybe.
Yeah, being obtuse.
Is this where you discover your superpower and it's shit?
You can travel me anywhere. I'll sleep like a log.
Just put me in a plane. I'll show you, yeah. Criminal.
Take that, supervillain. I mean, I'll not be a bit sleepy.
Do you think Superman suffered from jet lag whilst travelling around the world?
When he's trying to reset it, when the other way around, and he's like reverse time, he's like.
yeah, no, what I will say, Hal, is like some people really fucking make a hash and a fucking song and dance out of their jet lag.
Yes,
it's like, oh my god, I feel like a zombie, or like some people like full blown nausea and can't function for a couple of days. I mean, I think essentially because. I mean, you and I and others around this table, we're used to not sleeping.
Yes.
You know, I have a job that is unsociable hours, and also my leisure tends to take time unsociably. Yes. So, like, when you get there, there's none of this, oh God, what's going on? It's just, it gets dark, you get tired, you stay up for a bit longer, you go to sleep. You wake up, and as long as you get up and just start doing shit, well, you're fine.
Thinking about it, there could be a link between the fact that I've got a sleep disorder. I mean, if there's the fact that, you know, jet lag doesn't even touch me. You can't stop me with your slightly snooziness. It just doesn't really seem to sort of have that much of an effect no matter where I go in the world. Or...
It's just the shadow people get less.
It's an altogether different class of travelling problem.
Anyway, the topic isn't jet lag.
No, it isn't.
How, what we've been up to. How would you care to go?
Oh, okay. The most leading thing that everything's been sort of working up to has now done, which is the 3-day tour we did, my band Talanas did, with a band called Vulture Industries and Code. It's an extremely strange sensation to have something approaching sort of 6 months of... preparation, albeit slowly at the start, but leading up to that terrible crux of everything that would feature within leading up to a large, significant performance, which is like chronic self-doubt and string changing. Basically, it's a sort of... And it was only 3 days. I mean, I've done tours. I've done a 6-week tour of America. Doing 3 days is nothing. But because we'd not performed in over a year... It became this sort of, oh God, what are we going to do? And blah, blah, blah. And it was just that it's post-tour blues, which is definitely something that I think a lot of people, I mean, you've had it like when you come back from a holiday, you have the post-holiday blues and had very much that and sort of had a bit of a crash following the tour. But I don't want to get past the fact that the tour itself was fucking lovely. It was absolutely wonderful.
How were the other 2 dates? Because we saw you in London.
Well, thank you for
coming
along.
Wonderful, by the
thank
way.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you.
If you hadn't played in over a year, it didn't show, basically.
That's...
There was a lovely lamppost as well.
Thank you.
Did a lot of the work.
Yeah. it did, yeah.
I kid.
I was significantly more wooden than my metal lamppost.
And once again, thank you, Captain SICKBEARD, for that.
Yes,
yeah, I was just going to say. Yeah, it's basically, so I basically got our very own Captain SICKBEARD in to help me build a custom mic stand. Which, I mean, basically, it looks like a Victorian lamppost that's on fire slightly. And what it is the base of a, you know, those kind of wrought iron pub tables.
I've seen the bottom of a pub table, yes.
Preposterously heavy. And mark you, I am talking about something that you were going to be carrying on tour, and fuel efficiency is a thing. The preposterously heavy, solid iron table.
Did Hal choose aesthetics over practicality again?
Yeah, have I ever not?
I'm sorry, Joe. He's going to have to stick to one kick drum and a high
Certainly
hat.
Not.
He literally turned up tonight and went, I didn't bring a jumper. Exactly.
So basically, I got that, and then the in-between bit, so there's this huge sort of apparatus on top of that. There's all these angle poise metal bits. With it. I've got this custom mic and blah, blah, blah. But the bit in-between... our very own Captain SICKBEARD basically made a sort of candle effect flame lampy type bit that he did out of programmable LEDs, which is absolutely fucking amazing. He just turned up. Mark you, I'd sort of, you know, obviously we've got the association of here, but I've never met the chap.
I'd never met him.
I mean, I've talked loads, obviously, you know, there's here and then there's also email and planning the whole thing and everything like that, but we've never actually physically met. And the dude was waiting outside the venue when we loaded in with this LED device. It's just utterly astonishing. He just plugged it straight in, bang, happening. And he then proceeded to tech for us for the rest of the night.
Wow.
In the most amazingly efficient way. At this point, I was like, is there anything you need, Hal? It's like, well, you've already done so much. Yeah, but is there anything more you need? Well, yes, I've got three cameras here, and I've just not set them up. Oh, what a surprise. He's like, yeah, don't worry. When I went to go and look at the cameras the next day, and we were driving up to, where was it, Leeds? He'd filmed it and taken stills on the other one with my anamorphic lens. Bloody hell! So, yeah, that was absolutely lovely.
Check the show notes for a testimonial review. Complete with Sneak Dante's email.
He's
very much one of the most talented people I know.
The man appears to be capable of building anything. It's quite astonishing. I mean, there was various things that we were, me being me, I bought loads of flashy stuff to attract attention to the merchandise and everything, didn't check that it worked. And of course, you know, half of it doesn't. And then he just kind of turned his hand to it and just, it's just, poof, it's working.
Yeah, just like Jesus laid a hand on it.
Exactly. But it's quite amazing. But then, the other dates in answer to that, we did Leeds, which was a funny thing because we were not on the Manchester show for Vulture Industries, which we were supposed to be on because the promoter raced ahead and booked his own support for it without asking us. And then that show in Manchester for them folded because the promoter disappeared and the venue shut. We'd set up a show in Leeds as an in-betweener because we were going up from Leeds up to Glasgow. We didn't, a blank day is pointless. I set up this really dinky, just ramshackle show in Leeds that with three other bands playing on it. And, so I eventually just shot this email across to Bjornar from Vulture Industries going, your Manchester show folded. Do you want to come and do our gig? Yes, thank you. My God, we're going to play some shed in Bristol. It's like, well, this one's not much bigger, but it's better. It's more on the way to Glasgow. So we arrived at this show in Leeds and we've all done bad load-ins, yes?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, the equivalent. It's the next floor up of a pub, but it's like three floors up, if you can imagine the equivalent of.
Ouch.
And the load-in is via the fire exit, and it was raining, and fire exits as in made of, like, kind of, you know, the
iron grating.
Yes, and that is not what you want.
No.
So, yeah, that was. And Duff bit through his lip.
Snacking it.
Anger.
Yeah, he was carrying. We were loading off, and my preposterous mic stand thing. He ducked to. He was carrying a snare on a stand.
Aesthetics over practicality. Which
is entirely that. Basically, my thought. I thought he's going to kick off, and because he was so angry. But basically, he's carrying a snare on a stand, ducked to get under my mic, which was at a preposterously silly angle. And in doing so, the snare stand stood up.
Oh no.
Like, just straight up into his chin. And he actually legitimately bit all the way through the labret area of his lip, if you can imagine. Because I was like, hang on, no, wait, you're still bleeding, you know.
Visibly.
Yeah, no, so you're still bleeding. It's like, no, I've washed out my mouth. It's like, you've washed out. We'll do it again. Went off, did it. No, you're still bleeding. There's a hole in you. there's a hole. Well, you've got your mouth, you've got another one now.
So he's halfway to hell, basically.
Yeah. Just astonishing. So
shut up, Duff. You don't need a mouth to play the bass. Get on stage.
Yeah, nobody's listening anyway. But Glasgow, which we played the garage up in Glasgow, and I don't think I've ever been to Glasgow before. I could have done.
Glasgow's great tour. Fun.
Yeah, it's odd. I was expecting to be utterly violent.
Glasgow doesn't sound like the kind of place you'd forget having been to.
No. There's a lot of towns and cities in England that I've been to, but I couldn't tell you that I have, because touring is whichever film, it's Bad News, isn't it? It's like, what day is it?
Where are we? Yeah.
You know, and it's that kind of thing. You turn up a venue, you do the load in, you leave. That's, you don't see the sights. So Glasgow was very, very beautiful. But the garage there, we were playing the G2, the second venue they have, which is the size of most of the kind of O2 Academy sort of places.
Oh, wow.
It's just enormous. It's just this enormous stage. And it's like, this is the second. Wow, big's the main one. it's great.
Is that your favourite one of the tour, then?
No, well, I didn't do so well at Glasgow. I fell into Joe's drum kit.
What? What, to the point that the drum kit kind of...
And there is... And there is a photo. A very good photographer was there at the time, and she was taking some rather wonderful photos. She managed to get the exact moment that I lost my balance into his kit.
What were you doing to lose your balance?
Passing out biscuits, probably.
Yeah, exactly. I was head bung. Oh, headbanging. So
headbanging.
Wait, you were windmilling, and then you sort of.
I was windmilling, and I was enjoying it so much that I forgot that there's a bit. You know, Hal, come out of this because you know you've got a bit you've got to play that's really quite complicated. So in. You know, I tend to sort of, where I can, windmill quite low to centre of gravity, you know, spread the legs and just look well rock. You know, to do all that, and I was sort of, and get my spin on and everything like that. And it's like, the thought crossed my mind, it's like, not only are you really bad at playing this riff, there's an even more complicated riff following. Oh, bollocks. So I came out of it from the windmill and at an angle. But the problem was, is that whilst my concentration had stopped windmilling, my inertia hadn't. and self, like, you know, propulsion managed to make me go in momentum backwards, and then stacked it into Joe.
Aesthetics over practicality.
and I completely, totally I wiped out his.
There's a constant here, isn't there?
There is. There's a very clear and evident arc that everyone's like.
There's an arrow at the end of a through line that's aiming right for you.
X equals fuck plus one how. Yes, that's the constant.
And will I change my ways? Will I bollocks? But yeah, and I completely destroyed his kick pedals.
Did that result in the song stopping, or did you manage through it?
No, you played through it.
Wait, how did you destroy his kick pedal?
This is the odd thing. I fell into the kit, but in the most perfect sort of, because he was using someone else's kit, which is why I feel quite.
Did you just describe your fall as perfect?
It was great. It was a prodigious fall. It was absolutely masterful. It was. I managed to stack it right dead centre of where he was playing. You know, right, really at the kick drum, and folded sort of various arms and parts and everything like that. But in falling into, I'll admit, you know, I was in a lot of training leading up to the show.
13 years at RADA.
Yeah. As a penal sentence.
You are being transported to RADA.
Sentence you to learn Meisner technique and Stanislavski for 13 years, and may God have mercy on the second act. But yeah, so basically, in careering with the kick drum, it bent it towards him, and that therefore bent the beater on his axis longboard.
Ooh.
Yeah, which is not good. And so he had to improvise a lot of the last song.
To be fair, that sounds like something
a dodgy mechanic. Later on in the set, then.
That does sound like something a dodgy mechanic says to you just before you pay out thousands of pounds.
Oh dear, oh dear. What
bent up on the axis longboard?
Yeah, oh, what cowboy's done that? but basically, so he.
What was it? Windmilling?
Yeah, it's classic case of windmilling.
Fucking death metalers.
See some windmills in my time, mate. Oh dear. Yeah, but so basically.
Wide stance, was it? Yeah.
Practicality over
aesthetics. I rub on an inertia, was it?
Seen that before.
It's a killer. But basically,
you need your filters changed too.
Yeah. Basically, it's just got to the point where I kept approaching Joe later because I was so beside myself. I was like, oh God, what have I done? I've ruined everything. Oh my God. And I kept apologising to him. And at one point, I came over to be like, look, seriously, is there anything I can do? And I slightly tripped whilst I was carrying my... my rack, and he was like, just stop hitting me. This poor bastard, I've just been doing these terrible things to him throughout. Duff managed to trample his own glasses during Aorta at Glasgow, because he takes off his glasses, you see, at the end of Aorta, because he goes a bit mental.
Right.
And it's lovely, because he's quite a reserved chap, but you can see that, like, shit's on, because he'll just kind of, like, still be playing, and then just go to his amp, and just very, very politely remove his glasses, fold them, put them
yes.
there, and then destroy. And the thing is, he did that, but then because of the enormity of the Glasgow 2 stage, it really is, I can't get past how big this thing is. It's very high up. And he sort of, I saw him do it. He turned around to do the business and go and like take his glasses off. And it's like, there's a sizable distance between you and your amp. You don't have time. So, put it down on the floor. Bad. Because
oh, no.
Duff gets his stomp on when he goes horizontal. I mean, it's quite weird. He's sort of like, just bend over double. Did that, lost his footing slightly, crunched straight into the glasses. So, yeah. No, it was a good tour.
Cool. We've got to move on. So, Tobias, been up to anything cool?
I'll be brief. I feel like we've taught the intros.
No, it's
that's
right.
Okay. I'm going to talk about video games for like 20 minutes. It's fine.
Good. Okay, good. So, bad news out of the way. I've had some pain in my teeth, and I went to the dentist today, and I have tooth decay. And thus, I need a root canal.
Boom.
That's what I need for my teeth, because I have a lot of sugar in my tea.
Oh, yeah.
What time did you go to the... No, I'm sorry.
4:30. Or 2:30. Damn it. Yeah, so that's the bad news, by the way.
There was a big wait. The dentist was holed up in a room now. I delayed his appointment by 10 minutes.
So, yeah, there's the bad news out of the way.
Yeah, good.
So, yeah, positives. So video games, completing a lot. We're playing a lot of video games. I'm not really getting
good, man.
But I completed one called Turing Test. Wonderful little puzzle game and sort of fulfilled my desire and passion for all things AI and Blade Runner.
Beautiful.
Some Lara Croft game, finished that. And then I've been pushing Witcher, but because it's like Skyrim, but then I thought, you know what, it's not Skyrim.
Yeah, I was going to say, last night you were definitely playing Skyrim. Yeah, yeah.
Is The Witcher far in advance of Skyrim, so I understand?
No, it's
in terms
not.
It depends what you want.
But in terms of storyline and
it's interesting
your
you say
actions
that,
actually having
because
an effect on the story.
On paper, it might be better, but it's not...
I've never played it, and I adore Skyrim.
Exactly. Yeah. So don't bother. Okay. So we went back to Skyrim, and we've pumped Skyrim to the point where there's no juice coming out anymore. There's no side quests. There's nothing. We've run out of stuff.
Oh my lord!
So, Zemira, voluptuous Italian companion, she's been in the chair all day getting a tattoo done, replacing a very bad Batman tattoo for someone who has no idea about Batman. She's just very impulsive. she went and watched The Dark Knight and enjoyed it, so got a tattoo of it.
I
love her so much.
But she's covered it up with some with a deer head and a moon and some flowers. It has some meaning behind it this time at least.
She saw Warship Down. I don't
it's really beautiful. But as a well done for, there's a lot of paints, a lot of shading. I actually surprised her. Which hopefully she's playing it right now. I bought her Oblivion. So
because
in the same way perhaps that Witcher is a better game graphics and so on, Skyrim is better despite this with the older graphics.
Oblivion
I've
better,
heard
sorry,
Oblivion's supposed to be the best of them all.
No, Morrowind.
Right,
the one before that. But
bollocks! Bought the wrong one.
You don't even play Elder Scrolls, do you? You do. He doesn't.
I'll have you know, this man went on a fucking xenophobic rampage through Morrowind.
Yeah.
If I just witness a sort of gamer moment of, do you even bench though?
Yeah. Damn nice. No, do you even Morrowind?
It was a dagger in my heart when he said that to me.
I never got that you were particularly into them.
None of them have lived up to Morrowind.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Bollocks.
I found that game incredibly dull. That's interesting.
However, Skyrim for the mods. I think if you put some mods into that game, you would enjoy it.
I mean,
you can turn
quickly.
Every dragon into Thomas the Tank
Engine.
Yes,
just touching the Skyrim, just... Oh, the underwater Thomas
Skyrim,
the Tank
yeah.
Engine.
It's glorious.
all trees become big hands. Perfect. you can have a spell that rains cheese from the sky. Yes.
Very good. And apart from that, Rocket League, cocaine and Rocket League is possibly my favorite.
Do you pair drugs with games?
Yeah, very much
okay,
so.
Okay.
Skyrim is a ketamine game.
I love that.
Skyrim is a ketamine game.
Skyrim is a ketamine game.
What? I love that the final edit for you is going to be, Tobias, what have you been up to?
Games.
Well, getting the bad news out of the way. Cocaine and Rocket League.
But, Rocket League is a weird one because we clock so many hours on that game.
You
and
guys
it's
are
the same
so
thing.
Impressive at Rocket League. It's ridiculous. It's football with cars that have rockets on them.
it's game.
Great.
It's
really fun and really competitive and amazing. But
yeah, to carry on to be brief, the only other thing I thought I might bring up. So last time I was here, it was my first time here. Mm-hmm. Or this was my second time, would have been an easier way to say that. I didn't really know podcasts before, apart from listening to this one occasionally.
Oh, yeah.
But I've sort of just delved into the podcast world and really binged. A lot.
You've been on a heavy binge.
And for me, my highlight of them is those conspiracy guys. I think Captain SICKBEARD mentioned it a few episodes ago regarding a Titanic conspiracy, regarding the Titanic being a giant insurance fraud.
Good God!
Fantastic conspiracy. I don't think it's really true, but it's fun to listen to.
It is a fantastic conspiracy. That one.
That's insane.
It's the idea that they couldn't get insurance off the Oceania, so.
Oh!
So the Titanic was actually the Oceania that just went out again.
There's a lot of evidence to suggest.
Yeah, because they didn't have enough money. They couldn't insure the boat. So
what
they,
was it? White Star.
White Star.
White Star, like, yeah, yeah.
But I would, yeah, I mean, that was fantastic. And then from there, they mentioned in that J.P. Morgan, the guy who sort of was behind it all, the Illuminati candidate, he... And so I went into one about him, and then from there I've gone everywhere. I've done marijuana, I've done Tesla, all sorts of crap. And the thing is, I'm learning a lot from it, but also they're really funny. They're very funny. Two Irish guys just full of that Irish charisma, and their accent. If I find it strange, their accents are fantastic. When they put on a voice, it's perfect. That's not right for me, because they already have a voice. Like, they've already got a strong accent. For someone who has a strong accent to do another accent threw me off a little bit.
Imagine growing up in a country where all your media comes from outside your country. Yeah. That's pretty much
right.
It is a peculiar thing with the accent, though, the regional accents. So it seems to, well, to me anyway, that Irish, in particular Limerick, and a lot of Welsh accents seems to improve comedy by, like, you know, another half.
Oh,
it suddenly becomes much, much funnier.
Absolutely.
To whom, though?
Well, this is it. I'm trying to work. Does it mean that they're funny to themselves, or is it just us?
Because then
they're
just us.
They're so think it is just us.
Yeah. Yeah. Quick. Yeah.
Like, so when you said a strong accent, I'm thinking not to them, to us.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the you know, bigoted.
I had a Taiwanese student say to me today that I can't understand Europeans because their accents are really strong.
Wow.
And I thought, where the hell are you? Oh, that's right. People have different perspectives. That's fine.
Yeah.
It hit me in the face. I was just like, no. Yeah.
But yeah, so I would recommend those conspiracy guys after you've listened to the Pod Topic podcast, of course.
Cool. Interesting little fact. Lenin spoke in an Irish accent.
Did he learn from...
He learned from an Irish... Wonderful. Yeah, he learned English from an Irishman. So anytime he spoke English, he spoke it with a really thick...
So it's
a particular Dublin accent that most Irish people can't understand.
Wow. That's exactly like when you meet an Eastern European who speaks with an American accent. But oh no, sorry, no, not Eastern European. Let's go with a Dubai resident who speaks with an American accent they've learned from friends.
Like 80%, roughly, if you're just at a guess at it, 80% of the Finns that I've ever met, barring anyone from Tampere, basically they all speak as if
Queen's English.
Totally fluent English, but in American.
Oh, really?
Because and every single one that I've met that speaks in this complete broad American West Coast specifically. It's because, as you say, friends, and it's just like they learn from media.
Are you saying that their English and the words that they choose are more leaning towards British English? Well,
they're all about drinking coffee in Central Perk.
Yeah, yeah, no, really, it's quite
weird.
That's
the language, not the accent.
Yeah, but
that's what I'm confused about.
Their vernacular is from, I mean, admittedly, I'm saying this in England, so there's a lot of people come over, but they maintain the American accent.
A lot of people come over.
Brexit means Brexit.
Anyway, you know, we can come back to that.
Yeah, but it's amazing. They you know, adopt the vernacular but not the accent. So it's quite a weird juxtaposition.
Jonny, what are you been up to?
Don't worry about speeding this up. This is quite fun.
Oh, okay, yeah, fair enough.
And there's not really a lot to say on my part. The most exciting thing I've done, I think, recently is finish his Dark Materials for the second time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because the Book of Dust came out 6 weeks, 2 months ago, something like that.
Is this Pullman?
It?
Can you explain what that is? Yeah, I don't...
Philip Pullman's Dark Materials, he wrote three books, The Golden Compass, The Subtle Knife, and The Amber Spyglass.
Sorry, Golden Compass, was that made into a film?
Yeah, terrible film.
Yeah. Yeah. The one with the polar bear.
The polar bears, it's the... Yeah,
yeah, yeah, it's, yes, the polar bear.
You know that death metal, the thing with the shout?
Yeah, yeah,
right?
They're all songs about Satan. It's just noise.
Bravo. That was fantastic.
I don't know if I've said this on the podcast before. I probably have. But in Turkey, there is a phrase, çok satan, which means, like, new. So when I first arrived in Turkey, I saw in bookshops just lines of çok Satan, and chop means very. So I just thought it's very Satan!
Which is metal.
Yes.
What metal is.
And I was looking at, like, you know, autobiographies of political leaders. I was going, this isn't right. Like, just what? Where have I walked into?
Does daddy want a chocolate Satan? It's very Satan.
It is a chock full of Satan.
Well, actually, chock a block, our expression, comes from Turkish.
Really?
Yeah.
Good God.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice. Anyway, read those books. They're amazing and fantastic. They're no less spectacular than when I read them about 10 years ago. I will say, I like Philip Pullman. Philip Pullman slightly less, because the new book coming out, he described not as a prequel, not as a sequel, but as an equal. Don't you want to hit that, man?
Yes,
just a little bit.
Oh, that made me so angry.
What does that mean? What's he suggesting?
Is it a story that happens at the same time?
It's a fucking prequel. It happens before.
For his sake.
He's just being a twonk, basically.
He doesn't want the branding of it being a
prequel. Hold on, yeah, no, M. Night Shyamalan did the same thing with that Split film. The Split film came after Unbreakable as a sequel, but he kept it from the media that it was a sequel, because whenever you know it's a sequel, you, I don't know, you expect
preconceived
from it.
Ideas.
Yeah, and it always drops. Yeah. So I can understand where he's coming from, but the way he's perhaps portrayed it is a bit dig-headed.
That's the thing, yeah.
If I understand correctly, M. Night Shyamalan basically has been kept from the limelight, so to speak, by Hollywood for a while because of the stunningly shit returns he's been getting from a number of the films that he did. With the, was it The Lady in the Water or whatever it was called? Shockingly bad movie.
That was a crash.
Beth and I watched one of the most recent ones that he did about these two kids that are supposed to go to their grandparents or something like that.
Oh, yeah, the Visit.
Yeah. What an crock of pants.
No, I loved
did
it.
Did you really?
It scared the bejeebus out of me.
God, I thought that was just so
But you are a demon, so I don't expect horror films to scare you.
It was just crushingly shit. Well,
what did you think was shit about it?
It's just ultimately predictable. The dialogue is fucking appalling. And the character development is like, what are you doing?
Do you know what? I had no idea that. I'm not all a spoiler, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
The big twist. I had no idea it was coming. Perhaps because of ketamine.
Oh.
Well, in the immortal
spoiler, there's a twist in an M. Night Shyamalan Bing Dong song.
Yeah, I think that's kind of like your catchphrase by the sounds of it right now.
A catchphrase.
Yeah. Excellent.
It's hard to edit this show.
Took me a while.
Well, in the immortal words of Ram Jam, oh, M. Night Shyamalan.
Fantastic.
Really gets me.
Good work.
Cool. Anything else, Johnny?
No, I mean, that's pretty much it. Read this Dark Materials and, like, have a nice life, everyone.
So, shall I go?
Yeah, go for it, mate.
So, the biggest thing that's happened in my life in the last 3 weeks is two of my sisters have turned 30. So, we've had Beth, obviously my biological sister, and then also Kel.
Yes,
has turned 30. So I just want to take this moment, because I've not done it enough yet, is how you're fucking an over 30-year-old. Up yours. Fuck you. In your face. You're old. bearing in mind, my missus turns 30 on Christmas Day this year. So I've got months. Or, like,
weeks.
Yeah, a couple days. Weeks. Couple
yeah,
weeks.
Yeah. Days.
All right, I'm going to lord it over for that 2 weeks.
The time in our girls. that
I'm so long. apart from that, I've been playing video games, obviously. Come over to the Steam group. We had a lot of fun, me and Rickard, who we just had an afternoon playing VR, which was hilarious fun. Has anyone read Ender's Game?
Mm-mm. No,
I've watched the Ender's Game.
Was
it an Asimov or a
Liam Neeson's did do a film recently based on it.
Yeah.
It's Scott Card.
Was it? Okay.
The author. Yeah. And basically they do this thing, part of their training is 0G football with obstacles, full contact sport.
Excellent.
And that's what we were playing. That was Echo Arena, and that's so much
fun.
So
is this a cross between PUBG and Rocket League?
No, it's more Rocket League than anything else, but 0G with a goal, and you've got two teams of three. So first game I was playing, didn't quite get the controls down. I was just ricocheting, really not being helpful. Second game, pulled it together. I've got the controls down. We beat the fuck out of two dudes. And then the third game, we got destroyed by a couple of 10-year-olds.
Excellent. Online gaming.
Yeah, and it was that point where you can hear each other talking. So, like, the two teams you can hear both teams talking. And it's the point where these kids are destroying you, and they're just, like, setting up these strategic, like, positions on the battlefield, and it's just like, no, I'm not understanding what they're saying, so I can't actually interfere with what they're doing. I'm just going to go this way and try and get in your way.
Maybe that's the game plan. Maybe they're not 10-year-olds, but they play 10-year-olds talking to mess with your head.
So they're kind of reverse nonsense. They're kind of grooming you, but suggesting.
But the wonderful thing about being on VR at the moment is quite often if you're in a multiplayer kind of experience, you will encounter someone experiencing VR for the first time. And there was this woman who was clearly someone's mum trying on a VR headset for the very first time in like the lobby area where you're just like fucking around and throwing things to get your eye in sort of thing. And she's getting really freaked out because what we've realized as a group of people across the globe is this person's tried VR for the first time. We're going to fuck with them. It's the point where I've just thrown a ball at her face and she's just gone, ah! At which point someone's grabbed hold of the back of her character, held on in zero G, and just started doing a humping motion. Just like, and she's like,
my goodness,
she's
VR
like
rape.
A middle-aged woman from Yorkshire. Oh God, don't turn around, love. At which point she turns around, she sees it. Just, ah! Fantastic.
VR, we're raping.
Raping, right?
Yeah.
Oh, it was a dry
we're,
rape.
Consent is interactive.
Finally.
It was lovely because we were just having a chat with this lovely old Yorkshire woman. It was fantastic. And then all of a sudden someone would fuck with her and she'd get really freaked out for a bit. It was lovely. apart from that, I've watched American Gods. And when I say I watched American Gods, I watched it all in one day.
No! How many are we talking about? How many episodes?
8 episodes.
Okay.
Hour long.
Yeah, sure.
They're so boring.
What? Go fuck yourself.
I don't know. Maybe it's a nostalgia thing. That's one of my favourite books of all time, but...
Is it worth reading?
Oh, are you kidding me?
I've done a lot of gaming, as it were.
We've heard that about you. No. One of my favourite books of all time... Asks a lot of questions, doesn't give any answers, makes you interpret itself.
Yeah.
So you're saying there's a bias to like it no matter what?
No, because usually these kind of things, like, look at me with superhero movies. I fucking detest superhero movies because they're not going into the depths of a character or they're not really thinking about what they're doing. They're making a blockbuster.
Yeah.
Whereas this is kind of like cleverly interpreting the material. It's not...
Would you say the series matches the book in quality?
No. But,
no, it far surpasses it.
No, the characters themselves and the acting is superior to the book. Like, I got a feeling for those characters much in the TV interpretation. However, the story itself is an interpretation of that book, so it's a little bit more modern than the book, definitely, and that makes it feel more real, but it's not as hard-hitting.
I struggle. I think I've watched the first two episodes. I struggle ever since Lost... where I put a lot of hours in and was disappointed. I found that one. Stranger Things seems to be a big fuss at the moment.
I hate Stranger Things.
It's taking too long and I'm not getting the answers I want at the end of it. And I felt like American Gods... I felt like American Gods was doing the same thing.
Sounds like question time right now. This is fantastic.
Unfortunately, I will agree with you on that point because they finished the first season, they just won a second season. So it's a kind of case of like, Odin has thrown fucking down and shit is about to happen and you've got to wait a year before they come out with the next season. It's just like, no, but that's where it gets gold.
Am I right in thinking, because I haven't seen any of this American Gods depictions yet, but am I right in saying that they've got quite a stellar cast.
Oh, fantastic. Me. Lovejoy. Really
fuck me, that cast.
Lovejoy is Wednesday.
Yeah.
He's really good, and I didn't understand.
I'm sorry, Shadow, what's his name?
I don't know his name. So, when I was
Shadow
watching...
Shadow is
I was,
so fit!
Wait, is
oh my God, when he's I was watching so this, pretty!
When I was watching this, I was sitting down, like, really getting into it, and I was just, like, the entire time, I was going, fuck, where do I know this actor? I know this actor, but I can't think where from. And at some point, I turned around to somebody, and they said, are you sure you want to know? Because it might ruin it for you if you know where he's from. So like, no, he's too good. Go for it. You know him from Hollyoaks, and they oh fuck, it's him from that Hollyoake. Oh wow,
that would make it better.
He's done so good.
He's
for
an
himself.
Incredible actor.
He's brilliant.
He's good. So good. And then, like the point where the whole reason in the book is like the gods are fucking with him. Like, they're fucking with his perception of reality. They're questioning him as a human, at which point you're supposed to relate as a human questioning gods, sort of thing. But he is barely holding on to reality.
Yeah, yeah.
He's barely holding on. You can see it in his face.
Which comes across so better in the series than it does in the book.
Shadow is a very deadpan character in the book.
Yeah, yeah.
But I was going to say that
I think, you know, I mean, almost not exactly unanimous sort of liking of this piece is that it sort of stands as testament to Gaiman's ability to be just a very good story writer. However, I have to admit, and I'm on slightly dodgy grounds, it's not like Dave's going to listen to this, but yeah, I mean, basically sort of in having a relationship with the people who make these things, and anyone else who has a relationship with people who make things that they like, it becomes difficult for me to sort of be slightly critical about it because, oh, I don't want to upset them sort of thing. But I've got to admit, there's key works that Neil has done that I must admit I really don't like.
I've
never found him satisfyingly deep. I find him entertaining.
Okay.
Come on. But can we please get past that? That was an allusion to penetration. Moving on.
Moving in. Yeah, no, I'm very much the same. Like anything, like of his written works, anything outside of Stardust and Neverwhere,
is wonderful.
Nothing really quite takes.
Oh,
the ocean at the end of the lane was really thin.
Oh,
it was annoying.
I really enjoyed that book.
I loved it, but it kept not enough. The ocean at the end of the lane.
Oh yeah,
it kept.
I really enjoyed it.
Nothing.
I don't know. I like
very
it.
Very nicely.
There's there's bits that, like, for instance, I tried Coraline, which everyone's going nuts about.
Couldn't
stand it.
It's a bit paff.
And there's something that, I mean...
Well, I'm surprised you have such a strong reaction to it. I find it worse. Like, I would have preferred a strong reaction. I read it, I go,
okay. It's something that I get slightly concerned about, that in his writing... And again, I don't want to be overly critical of it. He's a very, 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 very good writer. But the problem is that sometimes I get the feeling that when he's deciding he's writing for children, my heavens, you can tell. Like,
he's what's the graveyard one? Graveyard story?
Chronicles, is it? I don't know.
No. I do know what you mean, because Beth is Graveyard Chronicles, I think. Something like that.
It's definitely a kid's book,
sure.
And it's a fantastic... What I get is the impression what Harry Potter fans must find in the first couple books is, like, that fandom. I enjoy that book because it's sort of innocent and trying to do a little bit of education, teaching the way of the world.
But it's just I can see his objective sometimes, and I just find that a little bit sort of like, well, you see, I speak to kids on this particular level. Yeah, but I'm partially convinced that pretty much, if not every single kids writer author has done that, but I'd say the vast majority of children's authors have gone, I have the voice that speaks to children directly rather than through their parents.
Apart from that, play Animal Crossing, Pocket Camp, shit. Install new Puzzle Fighter game. Brilliant. Anyway, apart from that. Should we get on with the fucking show? Because we're about an hour in at this point.
Johnny's got a thing.
There's just something that I forgot. You might not find it funny, you might, but it made me laugh quite a lot. A student today, doing a presentation on the connection between quantum mechanics and Buddhism, referred to the wheelchair-bound most intelligent man in the world as Mr. Professional Hawking.
Oh, lovely.
It was wonderful.
So, apologies for the very long intro, but I was having fun, so fuck you.
Punkcast. Hal, you've got something for us.
I do.
One from the Hot Pot, I believe.
It's from the Hot Pot, isn't it?
It is, indeed.
Okay. Right, so, this is from... No, it's not from anyone in particular. Actually, what is the intended purpose of the small brush-like Hoover attachment?
Are you kidding?
Cobwebs, maybe?
No, you don't need it for cobwebs. You don't need to scrub a cobweb. but when you have a deep pile carpet, you need to rough it up so that the little bits jump into the air.
Can we have like the appropriate degree of whimsy before we get to the actual answer, please?
No. We go backwards.
Okay.
We'll do the actual answer.
Okay, fine.
And then reveal that to be the conspiracy that it is.
Or maybe there's a secret.
By all parts of Hoover's.
Oh, it's
so
from me.
This is fine.
It's to give the impression of being sucked off by a very bearded man.
The real reason.
Oh,
Dyson, you dirty man.
Talking of which,
there I was. Adrian was noshing away.
I've got my own metric for when it's finally Christmas. And there's one particular meme, which is of, a large bearded gentleman with another, with like a pair of hairy man's legs going up over him as though like you're sort of POV being fucked by this dude. And just the words are, you better not laugh, because I'm coming in dry. And like every time I see that, it's like, oh, finally, it's Christmas! the brush-like attachment. Is that not the thing that you put on the end and it's got like the super long bristles on it?
Yep.
Yeah. Use that for going through thick shag?
Or maybe dogs?
Through a dog? God!
Oh, you can pile your way through a whole heap
He's
of bitches.
He's eating a whole kilo of dairy milk. Quick, get out the spoon Hoover attachment.
Oh, sorry. This custom guitar I've been having made for years and years and years and years and years.
Yeah.
It's come from America once before for the show last year, and it came back and then came along for this tour and everything like that.
Is it still not finished?
No, it's now finally. It's finished and done, and you've seen it, and it's wonderful, and I'm very pleased with it.
Because there's a lot that they didn't do to make it,
yes.
Right?
But yeah, it is a headless and small body. Yeah, quite. So it turned up, and Adam, my luthier, who was making it, it did a wonderful job of it. But he said, "Oh, because I have a very specific set of string gauges and stuff like that."
And
so,
well, and skills,
and skills. Yeah, very particular tastes. But my tastes are unconventional. But basically,
how many references can you get into a sentence?
but basically, I have these Elixir strings, and he said, "Well, it's cheaper if I order in bulk, but I'll just include them when I send it over, you know, to the UK and everything like that." So, oh, that's good. You know, I get a few spare sets. And the guitar arrived. And I opened it up, and it's like, oh, well, there are the spare string sets. Fantastic. They're not in their boxes, but fuck it, I'll go through that later. And I was on tour, and I was just sifting through it. I thought, oh, bugger it. I just might as well organise the strings. But going through those, I realised, okay, it's supposed to be three. So one's on the guitar. One complete set is here. But then the other set doesn't have the seventh string, the 0.068. So that's a bit strange. I'm like, well, Adam, you know, by emails, like, well, what happened to, you know, I'm not, you give them these things for free.
Yeah,
thank you
very
much, you know,
yeah.
But I just want to ask, is like, did something happen? Or was that, yeah, the dog. What? Yeah, that 68, it's not come out yet.
I'll post it to you.
Oh,
with
no.
Due haste.
Oh, fuck. Is this a surgery situation or is it?
I said to him, like, are you kidding me? This is a guitar string. He said, well, we have a strong suspicion that the dog had, because we found the one that's on your guitar in his mouth. Okay. And the other 68 has disappeared and the packet for it looked chewed.
Oh, no.
We are assuming it is in there somewhere. But it's like, but you know, a guitar string is a, like, that is a very, very, very sharp piece of metal. You do not want that inside any organism. Regardless of its quadrupedal qualities or anything like that, you know, this is not okay.
I don't know. I could probably live with one of them being in case.
But then he sent me a photo.
Can I just say, well done for quadrupedal qualities? That made me. Happy.
Let me say, at least the bitch needs to be detuned.
But the thing is, he then sent me a photo of the last thing that got stuck in his dog.
Drop D is what you should say to a dog.
Right, which apparently was a chew toy. It's a butt plug. No, it's a chew. No, it's Adam. It's a butt plug. That's what I thought when I bought it.
However, it did squeak when you squeezed it.
Yeah, this is the thing. It's like, Jesus Christ, if it doesn't work on the wife, will you work on the dog? You know?
Wait, in what shop is that a vague crossover?
An American one.
hang on, I now want a squeaky butt plug.
You've spoilt your Christmas present!
Apparently some awful bastard out there has actually made a butt plug with a whistle on it.
Oh,
that's fantastic.
There are butt plug fidget spinners that I love. those things are adorable.
Fidget bugger.
When you're bored of whatever you may be doing with
life.
A plug.
When you're bored of life, put this in your bottom.
I mean, it's just
the
an upgrade.
Wheel of misfortune.
When you're using your girlfriend's back as a chessboard, you're going to be bored of life.
I mean, if you're going to waste time...
You know the scene.
We've all been there.
If you're going to waste time, it's better than just having a thumb up your bum.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, to be honest.
It always is.
It always is.
So, the small attachment from a hoover.
Maybe it's to clean your fidget spinner.
yeah, there we go.
No, I'm relatively convinced that it's a corner attachment because you may note that most of those attachments have quite abject angles on them.
Are you suggesting it's some sort of carpet cleaning cutting in tool?
It's not though, is it? Because that's what you pull the attachments off to do.
Either that, or it's an underarm deodorant supplier. applicator, I should say. Applier.
Remover.
Oh, remover. Yes. It's a shame removal unit.
Remover? I hardly.
That one's nice.
I can't think of what you could actually
that
use it for.
That's chivalry. I like that.
I'm sorry, but I feel like I'm already...
I hardly. No, I can't possibly.
I couldn't possibly.
How dare you? She's ended up here, apparently of her own accord. I'm not going to deny her this pleasure. Away you go, lass.
Emma, I scarcely paid her dowry.
That was ostentatious, sir.
Has anyone got anything to plug? We are the Pot Topic Podcast. Let's go.
I don't know. Do you have a squeaky butt toy?
Oh my god, this podcast is going to be nothing but us screaming yay.
It's just a 1 hour and 50 minutes of
an hour of us doing one topic.
And then 10 seconds of ketamine, cocaine, and rocket rice.
But can anyone give me a practical, aesthetic reason for the Hoover attachment?
Me being fabulous!
I feel like I've already answered the question. You might not have been listening.
Definitely not.
I've definitely used this attachment.
That we work backwards. So we've answered the question, and now we're gradually moving away from the answer. Okay.
strategy.
Doesn't sound like
location.
I mean, small, manageable.
If you've ever cleaned...
Because the thing is, you start off with science, and then you get bored of that, so you go into pseudoscience. And that's just the progress. You start off correct and then work your way backwards until you have, a good story?
It's like Occam's blunt razor.
Anyway, Tobias, what was the actual reason? Razor, I hardly know.
I hardly shave.
Tobias, give me a sensible answer.
Have you ever cleaned a doormat?
Oh, haven't we all?
Do you know what you...
I've been one.
So lucky you brought your tuba in.
History's sad.
Children, calm down.
If you have a doormat, the mud is so deeply
entrenched
into the normal ones. Like you've got to add some sort of physical aggravation to get the dirt out.
I love it when you talk dirty.
is why I think it has a brush on it.
But answered. Lovely.
It's a brush and
a
Hoover.
We went from sense to nonsense, back round to sense. That was.
I am very proud to be the voice of sense.
Ketamine.
Good.
Cool. All right, so I've got one from Sophie's Chest, and this is from Aussie Dan.
You're right,
this
babe.
Is from the community. Inspired by the Southern Push, which mode of self-propelled transport would you use to journey across the UK? What's the Southern... the longboard.
Big owls travel across the South Coast.
I'd be well up for zorbing it.
Oh, dear Lord. I would... The nausea alone.
Well, no, I mean, because if you're controlling it, not rolling it...
Yeah, so the one where you run inside it rather than get to spin around it.
But when you do get tired,
you could just
flop, and then it'll carry you for a little way, and then just get back onto your feet, and away you go.
I watched a video recently that, obviously, of course, law of averages is going to be the amount of people absorbing at any one time in any sort of bachelor party will be enormous, and someone's going to get damaged. And I watched a video of absorbing accident.
I'm sorry, Hal, can I just stop you? Because there's a lot of smoke coming up from the radiator behind you.
This is vape.
Okay. No. I got really scared.
I work in a vape shop, you'll notice this. I had the same thing. I get used to the movement of vapour, very used to it. And
when it's a radiator, a bar radiator like that, because
radiator,
because of convection, it shoots the vapor upwards that way. In and if you do a really large hit in a column, and I nearly evacuated the shop. Oh God! Oh no!
Oh, Hal, you should absolutely do a solo album called "Followed by Fug."
Stricken with ennui.
Call it fun life.
Oh, yes. Oh damn! You got half a second before me. Damn.
There we are.
Yeah, so again, inspired by the Southern Push, what mode of transport would you, self-propelled transport, would you use across the US?
Sorry, what's classified as self-propelled?
I can only take
anything where you put the energy in yourself.
So basically, Big Al went from Land's End to what's the
I'd
most
already be there.
Point
I just realised who
South
we're talking
coast.
About. Right. I've never.
I don't actually understand the question.
Big Al went from Land's End to Beachy Head on a longboard for charity.
Who is Big Al?
Can I interject with a little tidbit?
And a listener, maybe, once, now.
I met Big Al through Diola.
Yeah, yeah.
And then discovered we went to the same primary school together.
Wow.
But only for, the first year or something. Small world. Do continue.
So seriously, basically, you've
on
got
a
to
longboard.
Yeah, he did it.
That's insane. Because the thing is, I've seen that it's much easier because it's all downhill. Because he's going from the top.
Nah,
of
mate,
the
it's fine.
The
they're really, really long. It's like two steps. It's fine.
It does. I mean, it does sound impressive, doesn't it? But then,
skipping a lump.
But then, you know, what's his name? Eddie Izzard doing a marathon. So really, Big Al was just slacking it a touch. So
we eat shit. However, I'm going to say, I'd do it in a car.
The question is self-propelled.
How about?
Yeah. Do you know what?
What I see is basically
a car of like I'm basically wearing something. I'm putting my two feet in, and then the rest of me, and I'm going.
Actually, do you know what? I've got a way around this. It would be fueled by your own biofuel. So you can rig up cars to run off human shit.
You can't fart your way from
not fart. No, but you can run it off human faking.
I beg to differ.
So if you ran it off your own shit, that would theoretically be self-propelled.
Look, I've self-propelled myself through my own shit for 74 issues, mate.
I disagree, because you're fueling it with your shit, but you're not the one. Your shit isn't doing the work.
No, you're absolutely right. Yeah, no, self-propelled. Come on.
What other options of self?
Oh, do you know what would be wicked? Is if you could plan out the route and do it on one of those old timey pump wagons for train tracks.
Yes!
Yeah.
That'd
be awesome. You wouldn't have any hands left. Well, you would. They'd just be mostly blister. But
I'd love to see people's reactions as they're heading into London for work. they overtake you on one of those. Morning.
Cup of tea in one hand. Morning. How are you?
I think the decline in those is one of the reasons for the divisions in society, to be honest, because they are the quintessential teamwork machine. It's perfect. Mm-hmm.
But also, you'd have to do it with someone so colossally tall and a dwarf.
So what you're saying is we should raise some money and get the world's tallest man, the world's smallest man,
and put them on a pump wagon.
Yeah, there we are.
I'm sorry.
That is a beautiful.
Send them around Britain,
sometimes they get tired of it, and the world's tallest man does the longest stroke, and the dwarf gets pulled up into the air, and then down, and like, oh, for God's sake! And then the rest of the time, the tallest man gets tired, and the dwarf's like.
Oh, what I love in that equation is by the end of it, the dwarves are going to have done so much hanging on, they're going to have lats like an absolute beast.
It's just this dwarf with this enormous back, with nothing else developed whatsoever, other than the supremely prodigious calluses.
What essentially you have then is a table.
I mean, what I quite like the idea of is as you're traversing the country in this pump wagon, say you're doing it by yourself, and it's obviously building up some serious shit on your hands, you could just pass an old, a proper steam engine where you got people shoveling it in, and then just as you go by, you show them your calluses and give them the finger as you go by. It's like, what the fuck do you think you're doing, you shovel bitches? Away I go!
The most clawed finger ever.
You're powered on Jurassic trees, I'm powered on hope. Fuck you, buddy!
I think the best way, publicity-wise, would be to go across the country in a canoe, but across land.
Yeah.
That requires real endurance.
Absolutely.
Perhaps stops to replace your paddle, because it's going to wear down. But that's, yeah. I think if I was going to do it, which I'm not, but if I was,
no,
that's
are.
The way I'd want to do it just for the fame.
Would the paddle run out quicker than the bottom of the canoe?
Oh, good. Yeah.
So if you had piles from the gaming that you're doing on the loo, is that the way that you're just going to just totally eliminate them?
Listen out for the bloopers. That might have to be a blooper now for that joke to work.
I think the piles gaming thing happened before we started recording. For anyone listening,
I'm always recording.
Well, how'd you get rid of your piles? It'd be my patented tarmac exfoliation.
Grind them down.
How did you get rid of your piles? The M6.
What you need, sir, is a good toll road.
I tell you what, I got past Birmingham bloody quick.
Bloody quick. All right, come on, let's go.
Anyone else got anything they want to add to, like, self-propelled UK?
I mean, it's obviously the obvious thing would just be the unicycle. I really am considering some sort of derivation of a penny farthing to travel me from Muswell Hill down to my work in Kentish Town. Because if I'm going to use some kind of poor people's transport, I might as well do it by full wanker. and so if I get a penny farthing, which is horrendously tricky to real penny farthings, I've discovered, having done some extensive research, because in the field it's important. And real penny farthings are prohibitively expensive. However, there are designs of bicycles that are available for roughly £200 that emulate a penny farthing. And I wondered, is it dickhead enough? What I want to see if I can really trick it out and sort of have, like, you know, maybe some LEDs and sort of many mirrors and stuff like that. But the arc of turn is you can't, because it's mostly straight where my path to work. So I figured that if
you want the workout, you can get like a 50p, 20p.
But be pedalling only the small one. You know, but so many mirrors and lights on the mirrors, because
just so you can see yourself from every angle.
And what I wanted
aesthetics over practicality.
And I wanted a newspaper stand as well.
Fourth one down, perfect.
just to get a there newspaper we are. Stand. Like,
So how about you get 200 people who inflate balloons and then just let them out on the rear end of a craft?
Hello, Captain SICKBEARD.
I like the idea that you'd forego mirrors in place of a newspaper. Like, someone's saying, but won't you know, the traffic might be coming in. Yes, but the economy crashed yesterday. That's far more important, you know. Like, the foresight I have is far in advance of these wing mirrors.
Like, they're merely looking backwards. Yeah. Ah, Brexit.
Next topic, come on.
Oh, no. I just realised what the next pot's going to be. This is going to be an interesting sale.
Oh, is it really?
It's the pitch pot time. Oh, it's pitch pot time.
Oh, no. Cunts with whimsy.
Okay, cool. So, Johnny.
Do you believe Tobias and Hal have never done a pitch pot?
I've never.
No, Tobias would have. Yeah, okay. Right.
Hal. It's been roughly 15 years since I'd last.
Hal's never gone full whimsy.
Taz.
Okay, here we go. Johnny, while you select one from the pitch pot. So, the pitch pot. Hal, and to listeners, new listeners, and there may be a new listener.
Hi, Mum. Good luck, mate.
The pitch pot is essentially a list of story titles taken from, Lewis and Clark. Tumblr.com. The person there have a neural net computer, and the whole thing with a neural net computer is you feed it some information.
Sorry, I'm already lost.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
So it's a computer that learns,
then outputs what it's learned.
Oh, good. Okay. So like that. What was it? The quotes thing. The non-inspirational.
Yes.
Thing,
yes. Right? Yeah. So with this one, what they inputted and what they asked for output was story titles.
Right.
And this is a list of story titles plus genre. And the whole thing with the pitch bot is we basically do an elevator pitch. We come up with...
Oh, very good.
We come up with a... Well, not it's not really an elevator pitch, but it
it's
never
an elevator
is.
Pitch that lasts a very long elevator time.
So, in other words, it's an escalator pitch.
The world's slowest escalator.
Yeah, or was it like the sky elevator that goes up into orbit? That's
if it broke down halfway.
Essentially, we want to come up with a three-act structure for
the
this
archway
story.
Archway elevator pitch, right?
Yeah.
Three-act structure, very succinct.
Elevator. I'm sorry.
I can't quite see her.
Not in this patriarchal society, thank you very much. Anyway, so, pitch pot, what we got?
So, what we are going for today is a sci-fi slash without a space fantasy capital F colon City of the Stupid film.
City Ooh. Of the Stupid. Okay.
Ooh, okay.
Essex.
Is this basically... Oh, what's the name well, of okay, that okay, TV
wait,
show?
Wait, wait, first thing. Sci-fi or fantasy? Which way are we going with this?
Fantasy.
Oh, no, or sci-fi fantasy? Or, like...
Fantasy.
Fantasy.
Somewhere. There we are.
Somewhere in between, which means now.
What was the Rise of the Idiots TV show? What's...
Set in the present day. Us. Done.
I mean, it's been done. Idiocracy, there you are. This is sort of case closed.
That was a woefully disappointing film. Anyway.
Yeah, it wasn't for Americans, I think. It was eye-opening for many Americans.
I understand the books a lot better.
We got there long ago.
I'm afraid it is. Yeah.
So, sci-fi fantasy...
You boys may be able to help me out. So, yes. The Julian Barrett TV show that was about a journalist that fell into the crowd of idiots in the music scene.
It's his name. It's
yeah. It's Dear Lord.
Oh, for heaven's sake!
Yeah. How can I? I'm just going to look it up and carry on.
Even one of my
Why do you need this?
One of the best quotes is, "You like this? It gets really good in 4 hours." And we did that every rave we've ever been to.
Okay.
So you're saying the
Nathan Barley.
Nathan Barley. Thank you very much. So it's basically the idea of, like, an intellectual journalist has been forced into writing articles for this subculture of idiots, and he realises idiots are taking over the mainstream culture.
Okay.
I mean, I'm sort of imagining that, really, if it's City of the Stupid...
Can't the city itself be stupid and the people are really intelligent?
Oh, brilliant. And they're desperately trying to meet on a municipal basis. They're desperately trying to better the city, but the city itself won't let them.
So this is definitely sci-fi because the city is an AI.
Yeah. The city is sentient. It's sort of like, no, I quite like those trucks in the way. Shut up. But garbage is my friend.
Can we call it mentient, as in it meant well, but it got it wrong?
There we are. Every good intention.
Okay, exactly.
Well, the only other...
The by road to hell and all that.
The other idea I had was a post-singularity tale, fable, wherein, basically, where we are now, we use robots and automation to do the hard work for us. Come the singularity, it all kind of gets a bit blurry. Post-singularity, AIs are now using us to do the menial tasks.
And we're all
a bunch of idiots.
I like that. It's almost Planet of the Apes style.
So are you saying that...
Well, isn't that the Eloy, though? That's just sort of...
Are you saying we're keeping the original idea that the city appears to be stupid and we think we're the intelligent ones? Actually, we've been played by a stupid city.
Oh, it's the biggest... It's basically
scam.
It's urban subtefuge there we are. on a psychological level.
Urban subtefuge. There it is.
There's the title of the episode.
Bill Ding.
Bill Dong.
Daddy is wanting to get high-rise.
Let's kind of explore the space a little bit. What does... Play with me in the space. What does a really intelligent city do that makes it seem stupid to a bunch of really stupid people?
Brexit.
Yeah, dude, you're talking about London.
I think maybe I would quite like the idea that...
That would seem intelligent to a lot of stupid people.
Welcome to me. basically, I like the idea that this city, that the position of mayor is almost punitive.
Boris.
But, like, you know, it's sort of like, oh, well, someone's got to do it. Oh, for fuck's sake.
As in, it's not mayor, it's meh.
Meh.
So you're saying the city hires stupid people to make it look stupid. So the city's hiring stupid people to make it look stupid, but really it's pulling the strings on the stupid.
It has elections, and it rigs the elections to make sure that you absolutely definitely appear to be voting for the worst possible person.
Oh, satire.
Yeah.
That's multifaceted. That's fantastic. I'm enjoying this. Yeah. Can we actually make this?
Do you know what? This sounds like a really bad episode of Black Mirror right now.
There was that protest, isn't it? That wonderful person that had the placard of being, "This episode of Black Mirror sucks."
That is very clever.
Spot on. I think, seriously, that Charlie Brooker has done something very bloody clever with that.
Really cliched and overwrought, but...
Let's not get into this. because
I knew that was going to happen. This will become a witch hunt. I knew.
So what is the story though? What is the narrative that runs through?
Do we want
this
a positive Hollywood ending?
No, this has to end Black badly. Mirror like, ending, I reckon there's got to be one person who realizes everything and then just.
And that person is Charlie Brooker.
I think kind of sounds a little bit 1984-y. Well, one person that's realised.
Well, and then he gets just assimilated back into the system and everything.
Exactly.
It was.
I think the entire city has a number of languages that no one can really get with. And the romantically speaking, there's one sort of the romantic female protagonist.
Capital R or lowercase?
Both.
Okay.
At the same time.
What?
And,
or either.
Yeah. You mean flowery shirts and emotion? Okay.
Precisely, yeah.
Okay.
And they have discovered this long forgotten tome of wisdom, which is called Lost in Translation.
Okay.
And they just want to experience what that's like, but then they realise that basically the entire city is trying to confuse them into not ever having anything worthwhile as a livable experience.
Because that's the only way to survive.
Because it's what you're trying to breed them on, stupidity.
Yeah.
But stupidity
actually is subsistence.
You're still talking about London, mate.
Oh, and the whole thing. So our protagonist, whoever is figuring this all out, and the journey is them. Like they're exceptional in the fact that they've had access to certain books that aren't usually accessible,
forbidden,
and they are a little more intelligent.
Yeah, it's not books; it's films.
Yeah.
So they got the chance to like.
I mean, we're looking for intelligent here.
Yeah. No. Exactly. So the forbidden books are stuff like The Notebook. And they watch this, and it's
a novel interpretation of Goldeneye.
I've got a final scene, but we need to get to that point. But I've got an idea in my head for a final scene.
Basically, Twilight is this really dark, forbidden tome that they're not allowed to read watch. Sorry,
this sounds like Ben Elton musical.
Can I? Before it leaves my head, can I give you my idea for a final scene?
Because
there was the idea of a protagonist. So I was imagining like a last train home on his own on a train, and he picks up a newspaper.
Oh, I thought you meant the TV series then.
No.
Last Train Home is a great TV
series.
Or
the, you know, paedophile anthem.
All right. Yeah.
Anyway, man on the last train home alone picks up one of the free newspapers, starts reading it, realizes that, in fact, he is the journalist that wrote all of the stories in this newspaper, and he still calls them fake news and throws it away. I don't believe a word of this.
And at that point, by the way, all newspapers are free.
There we are.
Oh, they're all the Metro. Yeah.
Because that is the ultimate freedom of information.
Yeah, they've confused the currency between freedom of speech and actual free content.
Yeah, there we are.
So now it's all of these basically completely unmonetized tomes and all this distribution that are desperately trying to compete with each other over nothing.
There we
it's
are.
Like it's like you can advertise in it, but it has no reach.
Lack of boundary means unbridled creativity. And
it's choosing which of the free rags, of which there are distributors at the edges of every public transport station, desperately trying to just go vying
and
for
there's
your,
an
for
infinite
your...
amount
again,
of them.
Again, this is London, mate.
that's what the city is solely designed to do, is to reproduce and distribute newspapers full of information.
But all the newspapers are the perfect mixture of fiction and reportage.
Okay.
In the way that what one has to disseminate is which is the fiction that appeals to you the most. If you're a romantic disposition, you end up liking this one free thing. It's like, yeah, you know, the Chancellor has a lovely haircut.
You're taken by that.
If you prefer the revolutionary stance, the news will be like that particular story will be the Chancellor had his hair cut by slaves.
So you're talking about basically the Daily Mail-O-Matic en masse throughout the whole city.
We have a contestant for the title of the podcast there. What? Daily Mail-O-Matic.
That's already a website.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you just click a button and it generates random Daily Mail headlines.
Oh, fantastic. Oh, I didn't know
that's
that.
That's a new pop.
Save that
right
for your
there.
Plug at the end.
Like, you know, immigrants accuse the Queen of giving homeless people AIDS or
but
something
Diana.
Like that.
But Diana...
we're saying act one, he finds this forbidden source of media.
I don't think it's a he.
Okay.
Or if it is, I think there's some sort of gender blending going on. I reckon maybe like call.
Surely in an ideal society there would be no gender.
Call him Lucy Gimble, but played by Jeff Goldblum.
Thank you.
Okay, so act one is them realizing the truth. Act two is them desperately trying to tell others of the truth, but no one's listening. And then act three is them giving in and falling under the spell themselves.
Part of the system. Done. We've basically rewritten 1984 for London, mate.
With a slightly more hopeful ending.
Well, yeah. It's nice. I reckon.
It's not more hopeful.
I reckon.
It's
from what? No.
Mine was very depressing. They've given up, and that's it.
Oh, they give up.
Yeah. I reckon the end of it is after your scene, Jonny, with the newspapers. Lucy Gimble goes to commit suicide by jumping off a large building, and in doing so, gets caught by some sort of energy net. And they've forgotten that all buildings have that now, and they realise they're just as stupid as everyone else and give up.
And that I also desperately...
Just fall and return back, and fall and return back. It's kind of Sisyphean.
What is the secret society behind it all?
Kawhi.
The Kawhi Illuminati.
And that I want there to be the line, I'll murk you blood, like, what with? An opinion poll.
And then someone gets a large pole and rams them through.
That's the opinion. But it's the
raggedest. That's what I think.
It's the biggest pipe you've on it, ever seen.
73% of sun readers said death.
I want a recount. Fuck off.
The recount is your autopsy. Fuck you, buddy.
Recount your organs. Right, anyway.
1, 2, dead.
Next topic, come on.
Tom... one from the hot pot. Yeah, please.
Can I not at all modestly commend us? That was rather nice. I like what we created.
Listeners,
I enjoyed it.
Give us a rating.
I would watch that. I would enjoy that.
Herpes, I'll tell
you
what. Harpies?
No, you wouldn't because the rest of us would be like, well, I think the writing's got a bit thin now.
I'll tell you what, based on that.
Must be somebody married.
Based on that.
Fuck you.
Fucking someone over 30, are we, Hal?
I'll tell you what it's like. Oh, wait, you'll find out in a moment.
Christmas comes for once
Chris.
A year.
Mass.
So, I'm going to say, listeners, rate us on iTunes based on just that topic alone. 1 to 5 stars of listenable or utter bullshit.
I'm going to say, always rate us 4. Always rate us 4 star.
No, 3.
It looks like there's been some critical thought going into it with 4.
I like that. That a lot.
4 is total film's blanket response to any film that comes out. That's not a good way to go. 3 is more credible than 4 at the moment.
I think a regular scattering of 3 and 5. Because it shows you're not just putting in the 5, that you are thinking about it before you put the 5.
You considered it, but you surrendered to the whims institution.
Can you please say that Northern Ireland accent for me?
The Whims Institution.
Thank you very much.
Okay, that sounds like the Whims Institution or something like that.
That's so, what we where got, Tom? I was adding.
Good.
Next topic, Golden Bennett. What is your favourite bean and why from Chris Helwitzer Bug?
Bean?
Okay, unequivocally, the mung bean.
Mr. Bean.
Oh. I was just going to say, yeah.
Rowan Atkinson, motherfucker.
How have How was it not the clitoris?
Topic done.
Yep.
Oh, man.
Can we have a commendable second place for the mung bean? It is remarkable. It has as much protein as chicken. It's really cheap. I love it.
Yeah, but it's also not a clitoris. We're done here.
It also is
to be fair,
it's got the same name as the juices that run out of a corpse and you punch it, but it and fuck it.
But it's not a very good bean.
You punch it and fuck it. It's your approach to relationships.
Oh, no.
Punch it and fuck it.
Go look up the Urban Dictionary for mung.
Well, you punch it and fuck it. That sounds like a very interesting way to sign into work.
That sounds like a lawyer.
No, that's how I sign into work every day.
Punch it and fuck it are the lawyers I want to employ in a libel case. Case for the defence rests quite hard.
Yeah, all right. Well done, Tobias. I think you nailed it there. Do you want to grab us one from Sophie's chest?
Right, okay. From Rikard. Hello, Rikard.
Hello, Rikard. Babe.
It's pronounced Rickard.
Oh, sorry. I'm going to pronounce it my way. he's Wellard.
Yes, yeah, because you're well English. That's what we do. Oh, what's your name? Oh, I'm going to call you Scott.
I'm going to call you Jojo. That's a deep cut for the listeners back in the day. Anyway.
Best beer type.
Oh, okay.
Not
best beer type?
Yeah, not IPA.
Cronenberg.
Why in particular not IPA?
Because there's too much of it, and it's just not that exciting.
And it's, doesn't mean yeah, it's all very, good, very dull.
I like IPAs a lot.
I have a particular something, some kind of digestive. I don't know what the hell it is. It's bad news when I eat bread or whatever and all stuff like that. So,
oh yeah, you're a poofter.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Put it this way: if I was born in Glasgow, I wouldn't have it.
Do you realise you just said poofter in exactly the same way that what's his name, James Masters in Buffy says the word poofter?
Oh, no, it was completely ironic. Yes, I do understand that.
So
speaking as a man who loves penis.
Basically I've realized that obviously it comes part and parcel with all these kind of digestive objections is that you're eating, you know, yeast and stuff that beer is, it should be off the map. And I've noticed that there's certain beers therefore that I'm okay with. And IPA for some reason, IPA and stouts, I'm basically fine with. But yeah. Someone has released, because there's a rather good pub, it's called the Rose and Crown in Torriano Avenue in Kentish Town, and they regularly have a sort of like turnover of guest ales and beers and everything like that. It's amazing. They have these weird, it's like orange and mango beer and but they had this one that was, what would you call it, sort of, I don't mean lactose, but like everything free. It was sort of... you know, like free for like wheat free and
the ultimate like safe that. Space beer.
Yeah, and it's sort of like I regret to say that rather predictably it was fucking horrible.
Yeah, of course it was.
It's like eating chocolate that has shit, yeah, man. Basically it's everything that you, but we did go for a tour. We took my father-in-law to a tour of the that's embarrassing. The Hop Goblin
Witchwood
Brewery up in Oxfordshire. And rather wonderfully, whilst we're going around it, they showed us the pellets, and these are literally condensed, desiccated pellets of hops.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to start talking that they put owl shit in their beer or owl vomit in their beer.
Right, exactly. Yeah, yeah. But it's as good as, given what we had, is that basically these are the pellets that we put in to do that. Rather than putting fresh hops in, it's far more expedient to do this and rah, rah, rah. So they did that. It's like, would anyone like to taste it?
Oh,
you don't
damn.
Want to eat those fresh hops.
So your father and I ate a hop pellet each. And oh my God, may you never, ever have to go through that level of discomfort. It blitzes your entire taste system, olfactory and everything, for a good 48 hours. We were given all these samples at the end of the tour. And now, this is our Breakspear pair and... No, I'm sorry. All I can taste is that.
Yeah, no, that's like eating a mouthful of oxidized pine nuts.
Oxo. It's basically like having a stock cube.
Oh, that sounds lovely, though.
Yeah, but
no,
hops.
But it kills your fucking palate.
Hops, which is basically almost as close as aniseed, as that will blitz your taste system.
So the beer I discovered recently, a type of beer I discovered recently, is black lagers. And I discovered this in New Zealand.
Red Stripe.
Oh, God.
Dude!
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Yes, but dude.
I discovered this in New Zealand. And
if you cover all of them in one episode, you're fine. You're back to square one. Keep going.
And it came in... weirdly, it came in a thing that was... It was a jar that was 943 millilitres for reasons we couldn't quite discern. We go into it in the interstitial.
943?
Yeah, it's... Do you know what? It turns out it's 39.999% of... 39.999% US fluid ounces. So, who knows? But a black lager is basically... You drink it, it's nice and thin, it tastes like a lager, but it ends with a soupy twist. That's like very stout.
M. Night Shyamalan kind of stuff. Yeah. Right, okay, got you.
But yeah, no, it's just... imagine drinking a lager that, like, halfway through just turns into a stout in your taste buds. It's fucking
all right.
Amazing.
When we were doing the Leeds show in this tour that I was mentioning in the intro and stuff like that, there's this pub downstairs, which is... utterly brilliant. It's called the Fenton in Leeds. And I strongly... Right. So thank you. They have the Fenton on tap. And on the cover of it is a bad photo of a chocolate Labrador. You know, and you think like, oh, of course, because it's Fenton. It's Fenton, you know, and everything like that. Oh, God, you know, stuff like that. And I said to the bar person, like, I assume that's because of, you know, Fenton and Fenton. And they're like, sorry, what? No, because it's a dog and it's Fenton and, you know, it's all the deers in Richmond Park. They're like, I'm sorry, what? Mate, we're quite busy. What are you saying? And it's like,
never mind. Give me a bottle of Peroni.
It's this thing. Can you find out whether it's that? It's like, yeah, well, give us a second. It's my first day here. Whatever. And he went back and asked the manager who was on that night and came back. And it's like, no, that's a photo of the pub dog. They have the Fenton lager, and they don't know what the Fenton YouTube a sensation is.
Or they were winding or you the they were, fuck yeah. up.
However, what I did have at the same time as ordering it is one, I think it's called 1,000 Cows. Right. It is a milk stout.
I love
milk stouts. Yes, milk stouts are good.
That is bloody incredible.
Yeah.
We got absolutely fucked up on that. After we played, we're just like, hang on a minute. Like, you know, Duff with bleeding and everything like that. As soon as I gave him two of those, he's like, you know, just like, fine. Because it tastes of, it's alcoholic milkshake.
It's beautiful. It's
really?
Creamy. Yeah, no, Rick, yeah, seriously.
I have now lent him.
Yeah, no.
There is interest.
And I will say, is the, if it's still there, God, in Camden, the diner, basically, just off, yeah, just opposite Wagamama, that they do the hard shakes.
Yes.
Have you had this?
Yes, I have.
Yeah, so that is legitimately
an
alcoholic
before, yes.
milkshake. The you can have a bourbon and, you know, and it's like, this is childhood times one. You know, it's sort of, well, this is exactly what you should be having.
Because it's far away from the place where Beth had her birthday a long, long time ago.
The 55 bar, that's nice. Yeah. But Stuart Powick, who has...
Well, wouldn't childhood times one be exactly childhood?
Sorry?
Sorry, I was just getting mathematical for a second. My bad.
Wouldn't childhood times one be exactly childhood?
apparently you are when you're over 30, so I wouldn't know.
For me, special occasions are made by Leffe.
Oh, good choice.
Not the radius?
Leffe Brown is...
Right.
Is the brown one.
I didn't get that.
No, but the blonde is... Damn good.
The blonde's on a par with Hoegaarden.
But I've got to say, like, one of my favourite beers of all time is no longer served anywhere, as far as I can tell, but it's the Cronenberg White.
Yes. Oh, Cronenberg Blonde.
I have Blonde. Heard about that.
That's was lovely. Fucking
that,
gorgeous.
That did kick the shit out of Hoegaarden.
Now,
it really does.
There is an app, I think it's called something ludicrous. You know, apps are just silly names. It's just like Rape My Ale or whatever. Rape My Ale?
That's what you said, isn't it?
Hop it up the bum.
Bro, the thing is that my basis stuff is a shareholder in a number of breweries and stuff. He's mad keen on anything alcoholic, essentially. His wife is a trainee sommelier and all this stuff like that. And it's kind of... But however, this app that he has promotes you whatever ale, lager, beer, stout, anything like that that you drink, that you go onto the app and review it and say that it's there.
There's quite a few of those kind of apps.
There are quite a few, but he's on the leading sort of one. And his stag party was a tour of all the independent breweries leading up to London Bridge. You know that weird sort of, that there's an avenue leading up to London Bridge, but essentially under the railings, which they have all the archways.
Mm-hmm.
And there's all these microbreweries.
Yeah.
And they're obviously promoting that they hope that you'll go in there and taste absolutely everything. So you buy, as it were, quarter pints mm-hmm. on a, like a kind of shots, disc.
They usually put them out on like wooden board, paddle things, almost like a cheese board or like you do with the whiskey. Yeah.
Duff, as it turns out now, he's escalating further and further and further into this through this app.
He's moved off the shitty Polish lagers.
Yeah, quite. But he's now started to be, as it turns out, rather revered on this thing about this guy knows his stuff, and it's like, what a reputation!
Yeah,
you're
yeah.
that much of a fucking lagerhead that you're just like, oh no, well this guy knows because this is a session, this is a cheeky session, this is a you know, it's like, well, okay,
is that a technical term?
Cheeky session,
a cheeky session.
Yeah, you said this to me.
It's the most British thing I've ever heard. It's got to be said. It's because of microbreweries that I rate IPA so lowly, because every microbrewery does their own IPA and they all taste. Yeah, exactly. They all taste like wet, savoury grapefruit.
However,
they're just nothing special.
I have ultimate sympathy for any IPA or anything that loads it with hops because of the fact that, and this is totally stupid of me, but because of Kent and the fact that the abundance of hops and the fact that there are international breweries that will import Kentish hops because, like with the whiskey
tradition.
And the...
More than anything, with Kentish hops.
Yes, but you know, long may it continue that apparently the Kentish hops have far surpassed.
Pellets weren't coming from Kent. They're coming from France.
They're China. It's like Shenzhen are producing hop pellets at the fraction of the price.
I'm gonna just say right now, best type of beer, fucking Elvis juice.
Elvis juice is very good. I would put that as a close second.
Brewdog Elvis juice.
Best type of beer, cheap.
Darren, can you tell me the story of why it's still allowed to be called
this
Elvis
is
juice?
Fucking amazing. So the whole thing with Brewdog's Elvis
grapefruit
juice.
Grapefruit pale?
Brewdog is what Duff has the shares in.
Oh, yes, I remember you telling me.
Mega sold out brewery, by the way.
Yeah, but still
how
pursuing.
How did it sell out?
So Brewdog's whole thing is they named this beer Elvis Juice, and Elvis Presley's estate came in and tried to sue them about the name.
Did they say it was after Elvis?
King of Beers. They're pursuing because Budweiser have the trademark of King of Beers.
Right. Okay.
And they were attempting.
Oh wow, that's a fucking reach, isn't it?
Isn't it? But they were attempting to basically undermine. Budweiser's King of Beers, and so they approached it and called it the Elvis.
Yeah,
Elvis
so like,
this is a sidetrack, so you can talk about it later, but where do you stand on trademarking?
No, hang on. Give me a second.
Let him tell the story.
Brewdog's board's approach to the entire thing, as far as I understand it, is in order to like hold on to the name without any litigation, was they changed their name by deed poll, like each member changed their name to, by deed poll to Elvis.
Three of them.
Three people renamed themselves Elvis
by so
they continue keeping the name.
Sorry.
It was grapefruit beer. Was it like they deep pulled their middle names?
No. They legitimately changed they retained all their names, but they legitimately changed all their first names, and therefore nominal points, to Elvis to reinforce, and this is their in anticipation of a tort case. So that their defense.
You heard that as well, Johnny. A tort case.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
This is very tense.
It's a bit of a tort case, to be honest.
Practicality. You know, fuck that.
They expected to teach this to people at some point.
It was in the hope of bolstering their defense, which was Elvis is simply a name in the Western world.
Yeah.
It is not exclusively synonymous with Elvis Presley. We can do whatever we want with the name Elvis, and you can't lay claim to the, as you rightly say, trademark of Elvis being king of. And
why does one have to name themselves Elvis three times?
Because in order to prove that,
there's already other people called Elvis.
Because they're
amazing Scottish brewers that decided to go fuck you, America.
It turns out, interesting you say about being sold out and stuff like that. That they had an offer from, the umbrella name that owns Budweiser. Basically Brewdog refused an offer from them.
Good.
To the tune of something along the lines of 13 million.
But didn't they sell out to some big brewery? They did, but to the point at which
they could retain still administrative control over
and,
it.
And so still put out decent fucking beer for a large production.
I still think that Tactical Nuclear Penguin is the best thing they've ever done.
Thank you!
Absolutely.
Yeah, how much of that have you had?
And then Nanny State is absolutely
a decent
perfect.
Non-alcoholic.
That's just political satire, and then also fiercely popular.
Yeah, it's very, like, very good non-alcoholic.
They've released a limited edition beer where all of the proceeds go to a charity supporting climate change called Make Earth Great Again. And the picture on the label is a robot Donald Trump being attacked by a polar bear. It's fantastic.
So basically, answering the topic, milk stout.
or maybe black lager.
I would feel really bad if I didn't put this one in. About 2 years ago, Flying Dog released a mango habanero IPA, which was absolutely fucking incredible.
Oh, I'd love.
And then it's gone forever. And
anyway,
I'm so sad.
This is more boring than me talking about video games.
And also, one more thing.
Brewdog
have a new Christmas beer called Hoppy Christmas. We're done. Cheers.
Hal, you've got one for the pitch pot for us.
Pitch pot, what you got?
So, genre and story title, please.
Right. So we have horror.
Ooh.
I hardly.
The Steel-Pounted Murder King.
Steel pounded.
Yeah, can someone come on? Someone explain what pounded means to me.
This is the point.
Okay, put out
a word that it doesn't quite understand.
The steel pounded. I quite like the idea that it's basically a cryptocurrency based on print. It's cryptocurrency still, but they do print their representative currency in steel.
Okay.
So it's like Bitcoin. But
actual physical, but tangible steel.
Hard as fuck.
Okay.
So basically...
And also you can't carry it in your wallet because...
You can't because it's just...
Like each coin is about half a metric ton.
So you had hedge orcs in a vault carrying it around.
And the whole reason that they started doing the steel pound, pounded sort of thing, is because they had already experimented with making a £20 note out of odmium.
Odmium. Oh yeah, no, that's actually
Okay. It was so heavy.
Steel pounded. Sorry, I'm not sure.
It was so heavy that it made Bangladesh finally sink into the ocean.
I'm with Jonny on this. Reread it, please. Steel pounded.
Steel pounded murder king.
Thank you from the audience.
The steel pounded murder king.
Steel pounded murder king. Okay. So basically, we need to establish a degree on what guys.
I'm gonna have to stop this right here.
Someone just googled urban dictionary and pounted.
I just googled it. The word pounting, and the first thing it came up was urban dictionary for pounting. Pounting is when a girl climbs on you and rubs her ass on your dick, but you don't stick your dick in her pooper. That's wrong. Instead, you just rub their ass on your dick until you come. That is pounding, ladies and gentlemen.
But how do you steel pound?
Yes.
It's with steel panther. If you do it with steel panther.
I've got it. Steel pounding is when you have Viagra and you're pounding a girl.
It's a Mexican that's been doing it for a long time.
Right, yeah, no, exactly.
Steel pounded
murder king is essentially speaking, it's this Viagra fiend, right, who has now got to the point that he's dead set on killing a woman from basically grinding her to death on her bum.
Okay.
Okay, no, I'm going to say this...
Does he call it his opinion poll?
The opinion. So I'm going to suggest maybe this is a horror based of. Oh, hello.
But it has to be horror, though. No, as I say, I'm saying he's dead set on. He figures if he's going to take steel pounding to the correct degree that it requires, he has not just to kill girls by grinding them.
I don't think gender was specified.
He has to be specifically the best at it. So now what he's going to do, he's going to write to the Daily Express to instigate an opinion poll on whether he is in fact the steel pounting murder king.
See, now I reckon this is more a horror.
But it does in fact say that he's steel pounted, which suggests that it's being done to him.
Maybe it's happened
to him. He's a murder king that's already happened to him.
Maybe this is a tale of retribution. Like tantamount to the crow, but anal.
A lot of abusers were abused themselves, so a lot of pounters were pounted.
Maybe it's projecting. Maybe there's a concern that he's just basically enacting some sort of bitter revenge onto an anal community that's just sort of.
So what I'm thinking is maybe a
anal community,
a horror film that's based off of male insecurity, and the whole thing is we create a generation.
All horror films.
Not all. Some very specifically, but not all. But this one. Very, very, very specifically. So we create a, mankind creates sex robots. And they eventually get the better of us. And the way they get rid of mankind.
What, French people?
The way they get rid of mankind is, these sex robots, basically they pound men. And you say, as long as you can take the pounding, we can fuck properly. But then all men just, end up coming on, shiny steel buttocks. Yeah. And no one has any sex appetite anymore.
Because ultimately they're unfulfilled. But however, I think also one has to accept that the very real possibility is that if one were to go to, Cambridge... And then you could be missold a sort of, canal river adventure of pounting down the river. And instead what it is that this dude has the opinion poll that you think is a pounting poll, but instead he puts it up you
and then
suggests that he's just pounting.
Sorry, Tobias, can you pass
me the topic, conveyed down the river?
I'm going to offer different, perhaps more realistic solution.
We're forgetting about the murder.
Ever the pragmatist, Tobias.
Pounting, I'm going to take away from the Urban Dictionary definition. Pounting could be the point where you hold a pout in a photo for a certain amount of time. So if you can hold a pout for 3 seconds, you are definitely pouting.
You see, I absolutely disagree. I think pounting is, in fact, the vernacular for a reference to simply a shiny pound in Balham.
It's a pounting! Yeah.
The pounting!
Because
that's not by any way...
It's pounted.
Oh.
Yeah, so what I'm suggesting, as the murder king, he is someone who murders his victims and then takes a picture of himself with the same steel, blue steel face, pout, that makes him iconic. That's his signature.
Okay, he's takes a picture of himself pouting while pounding someone to death.
And in turn,
they're already dead.
And in turn, therefore, framing himself, like desperately appealing to the forces that govern us, please stop me before I kill again.
The social media killing.
Sorry, quickly, that'd be the pop of the Tamnuvalin.
Tamnavalin? by the way, we're starting a second bottle of whiskey.
Good luck.
I don't know where we are. By the way,
we're at the end of the podcast.
We are not establishing a plot, a first, second, or third act.
We absolutely are.
No, we've got no ingredients.
We are wading through the
I'm sorry, but I absolutely disagree. I think Harvey Weinstein would lap this up.
Mm-hmm. As well as all the juices from the ladies that were...
Yeah, there we are.
Now that's profiling.
Do that.
I want some anti-filing.
Okay, so let's pick. We've got three options in front of us. The pounting as in a sexual act where you don't insert. We've got what was your suggestion as a pounding?
A discussion of the pound in Balham.
A pounting or pounting a selfie pouter.
See, I actually quite like the idea of a the pounting. So you're getting mugged by someone. So can you give me a pound? It's like, sorry.
I want the pounding.
Yeah, you know, it's just a pound. And
give me that pounding.
Give me a pound. And then
I hate
murders.
To be a stickler for grammar, but it is in the past tense. It's pounted.
Oh, hang on.
It could be an adjective, which in fact is.
Sorry, hang on. So is
Steel
it possible?
Pounted is a compound adjective. Come on, guys.
Is it?
Oh, yeah.
God, it was so obvious. It was standing there all the time. How silly of me. But, like, I reckon maybe pounted is basically, it's a misunderstanding from a person that is illiterate, who has been told about the internet, and that has been told through Chinese whispers, as it were, which is not the term that you're supposed to use anymore.
No, it's called a game of telephone, but never mind.
But nevertheless, is that it came from pwned, from being pwned, but his name is Ted. So he's constantly being corrected by his friends who know a lot more than him because he's illiterate, because he can't learn an awful lot. He is constantly, as far as his friends is concerned, being pounded. I mean, anything that he does, when he tries to expound some sort of, like, you know, wisdom and something, it's like, it's evident, it's so crushingly wrong. And his friends obviously correct him, but he's just like, well, they're just being like, you know, I'm just pounded.
Again, I hate to be a grammar Nazi, but it's pronounced owned.
Yes, yeah,
no, but that's
why
I'm saying
right.
It's a misunderstanding.
Well, yeah, okay, so this is like a hillbilly horror. But the, like,
so he now has to enact his revenge on all of his far intellectually superior friends for every time they said, Ted, it's not steel, and aviation fuel can melt that much. And it's like, mate, no. And he's like, oh, it's just another moment for pound Ted. It's like, no, I'm not saying that. And then he stabs him in the face.
All right, so first act, second act, third act. Come on.
Right, first act is pound Ted basically being born, at which point his dad slaps him in the face for being such a stupid arsehole.
Well, no, it starts off with hillbilly Ted. I reckon he's got to be hillbilly. Like, the level of misunderstanding here.
He's from Norwich.
Yeah, hillbilly.
Yeah, there you are.
Yeah, but hillbilly, like Billy Goes Gruff? Is that like... Is there a connection?
No.
You're just trying to confuse the issue, aren't you?
No.
Apparently his name should be Mike. I didn't understand
literally,
that. What do you mean?
He's big into speed, and he's born up a mountain.
Okay.
He's hillbilly.
Like, he's like on his way up to a mountain.
No, he's already up there, mate.
Okay.
He was born up there. It's like a kind of Spartan problem.
Not with an E. Okay.
It's a sort of like, yeah.
Okay. Bleh.
Second act.
Second act is his sexual realisation.
Good.
Okay, so he reaches this moment of, like, really sort of, really odd pubescence.
Is
where,
this when
where,
he's pounded?
Yeah, no. He has his first experience, suggestion of being pounded.
Okay.
Okay.
But which happens through online gaming, as far as I understand.
Yeah, basically. But the thing is, the saddest thing about Ted is the fact that he's online, but he still can't read. He's still illiterate. So he's just looking at the pretty pictures. And all this stuff is scrolling like a sort of RSS feed at the bottom of the screen about how fucking stupid he is. And then at the third act is when he starts to has a rudimentary command of illiteracy. And then he realizes what this feed is at the bottom of the screen of being like, Ted's a dickhead. Ted's so stupid. Ted's a... And then he goes on this mental murder rampage.
Okay, there's the horror.
Oh,
okay,
yeah. Cool. Can I add a little, little flavor to Act Two there? Like his entire life on, online gaming means that, where we would hear racial slurs, that's just what you think you call mate. Like, as we all know, like, racial slurs are prevalent. And I'm not going to say them here, but it's just like, oh, you're just a, and it's just like, dude, to him, it's like, you're just a person. But obviously to us, the actual word itself, which let's just, well, I'm not even going to go into it, but like, he has a completely different understanding of, like,
that was a paragraph of one person avoiding one word. That's amazing. You basically went through, I'm not even going to say it myself, but I'm just amazed that you basically went through.
Well, wicked! This has become a second paragraph of two people avoiding one word.
Right.
Let me butt in here. Nobody other than Tobias. I also don't want to say the word, so let's push this out to a third person. Well,
let's just leave it to Tobias because he takes ketamine.
Oh, the temptation to say the word is intense.
Ninja.
Next topic.
Yes. Next topic.
Yeah, I think we've bailed out that
last
one.
Last topic. So, this the last topic. Possibly the hot we're getting pop. Sloppy.
Yeah, we didn't quite put a story from that one, and that's fine.
Excuse me, I fucking worked hard.
Sorry, I fucking did.
To be fair, you managed to tie into a horror story as well at the end.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
It was an origin story of a horror film.
Listen, I've that makes me very happy.
Right, listen, I've left this open not only for a second series but a prequel.
All right, American
and
gods.
And an equal.
You're absolutely right.
No, I don't do equals.
Get out.
For the Pullman.
you're absolutely right.
I'm
sorry.
Already out, been out for years, darling.
I'm sorry, I rescinded everything.
No.
Rescinden? How can you rescinden? My wife's been trying to do that for years.
By the way, if this guy over here ever has a loaded opinion, can we say he's Tobias?
He's Tobias.
Hell yeah.
Okay.
That makes you really happy.
Excuse me, only the court will decide.
We've got another one from Tom. From the hot pot.
Shit.
Do we need a nicer, friendlier, more familiar name for our listenership? Any suggestions?
Sorry, listenership? What, be potheads?
HMS cunts.
That's the obvious one.
Well, yeah, and we've suggested that in the past, but we've never really stuck to it.
No. So come on, let's come up with something better.
Any name, take to pick.
So topic is, I'm going down the Brexiteers route, but sort of like...
Topicos?
I fucking love Tropico.
El Presidente.
Does Diola listen to this?
Yes, of course.
Diola. El Presidente. Thank you. Sorry.
Okay, so...
Petonians is wrong, because that's...
I'm going to start off on a nice note. So, the Game Grumps guys, look them up on YouTube, they call their listenership the Lovelies. And that's nice.
What's
Lovelies.
But is it related to their name? Or
absolutely not.
Well, then why...
It doesn't need to be related to our name.
That's shit.
Yeah, you're right.
Well, okay, so...
It's very nice.
Then our listenership are the Darlings.
Yeah, that's not right, is it?
No,
because
they're not Darlings.
We've spoken to many of our listenership.
No. Okay, so the thing about...
Lovely fuckholes.
If you've listened to more than one episode, more than this episode, and you've come back for more... Then that means one thing.
You're sadomasochistic.
You are one of us.
Sorry.
And if you are one of us, that means the collective would be the sum of us.
Sorry, hang on. I've just realised. Isn't this...
I like that.
It's just called the listenership, the sum of us.
But
with S-U-M or S-O-M-E?
Doesn't matter.
Isn't this staring us right in the face?
Go on.
They're the Potters.
Oh, fuck.
No,
right.
It's been taken, mate.
Have you seen... we could remake... Have you seen... You've seen 300, yes?
Yes, of course.
So there is a point in 300 where the Spartan army is standing in front of the Athenian army.
Yeah.
Exactly. And he asks what your profession is. And the first guy's like, blacksmith. And then it turns to a guy, and he is so bloody proud of his profession.
I'm a Potter, and he's really happy, and then all of the Spartans, I feel so bad for that guy, because he's really proud of what he does, and in that moment, it's destroyed.
Yep. I hate the feeling of anyone listening to this podcast being proud.
No, but why would you not be? Because you've got to listen to this banal nonsense. You've got to be proud of the fact that you made it through two and a half hours of abject wankery.
There it is, Tom.
That's aesthetic affront.
They're not our listeners. They're our endurers.
Oh, endurers. Yeah. Okay. I think you've nailed it.
That's done it.
That's teamwork. That is teamwork.
Marathon listeners, endurers.
I think I prefer the endurance over the endurers. Is the endurance even a word?
It's an entire whole. The endurance is the collective. It's almost like
When more than one of them congregate, it's called an endurance.
Yes.
But singularly, it's an endurer. But the endurance is enough as an. And it's not
really
a flippant
like
term.
Like
that's
that.
Brilliant.
I really
like
that.
It's called a unit because there's always only you there. It's basically
if there's a few of them on their own, but there's more than one, it's an endurance of it's a tolerance of endurers.
There we are.
Can I just say probably the king of endurers is Rickard.
Oh, fuck me, yeah.
Just sorry to make your life more difficult, Tom, but possible name for the episode: The Birth of the Endurance.
Oh damn! Damn! All right, yeah.
Embryo endurance.
Okay, I don't think we can take that topic any further. So
no,
let's fucking wrap up this show.
No, let's not. Let's actually continue until Tuesday and then really test the endurers is to see if they can actually withstand a 72. No, hang on, Tuesday. A 200,563.7 hour. Hot Topic Podcast.
Our I hardly. So
helped her.
Does anyone have anything to plug?
Well, hang on, we're only at 146 here.
No, we're not.
Oh, okay, some forgetting.
Yeah,
yeah, fair enough.
Right, I'll take the lead on this. Those conspiracy guys. After you've listened to this podcast, go and listen to those guys.
Or maybe Tobias caught note in music.
No, let's not do that.
Well, Northern Beast?
That doesn't exist anymore. Northern Beast?
Is it the Northern
Beast? The Beast of the Southern Wild is a nickname I picked up through
wicked.
A lot of drug taking. Sorry. those conspiracy guys, give them a listen. They are very funny and informative. There we go, that's my
plug. Please tell me that you don't actually invest, I mean, it's interesting.
Money in it.
You don't sort of invest belief into each.
No, neither do the guys.
That's what's quite good about them. They throw out all of the facts, everything that they've found online, not all facts, and then at the end of it, in some of the episodes, they'll spend hours talking about this conspiracy, and get to the end, we go, nah, it's bullshit.
it's just that I have a friend of mine that's an absurdly talented photographer, Paul Soso, that's just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful photographer. And he's great fun to be around, and he's originally from Edinburgh. And he has several kids, and he's getting on in his life, sort of thing. He's
Tinder profile.
He's arguably middle aged. However,
I have several kids. I'm getting on in my life, and I'm arguably middle aged.
Right. So
that's Tinder.
Right. So
hashtag swipe right.
So however, he is an absolute slut for anything conspiratorial at all. He's an absolute conspiracy theory king.
Yeah.
And I find it insufferable. I can't deal with it. And it turns out that amongst our sort of group of friends, as it were, I apparently am one of the only people that are prepared to sort of say, look, I'm sorry, Paul, but no, that's not the case. When he said to me about the vaccines thing, and he has three children, by the way, I'll just reiterate, he has three children, and he's anti-vax.
Has he not vaccinated his kids?
He has not.
Well, then his point is null and void. Right. Let's get on.
So I've attempted to have a bit against there, and I started because my brother, or I should say surrogate brother, is a doctor, and he's sort of like I have a man of science, So he said, like, you got anything to back that up? So yes, indeed I do. He said something very telling to me. About two parties back, he said, "I tell you what, all the stuff that I do say." I rely on you. You are one of the few people to counter me with decent arguments. It's sort of like, I think it's more that I'm just prepared to go, coincidence exists.
Well, it's my primary argument is always...
Again, not a topic.
Incompetence is more likely than planning.
Well, I think in one of the most beautiful reasonings, the rationale sort of thing of conspiracy theory and everything like that, it's fascinating to hear. It really is genuinely interesting.
Oh, I love it. There's some of the best storytelling.
But one of the most telling things about it is that it's a bunch of people who are simply not prepared to approach the possibility that coincidence manifests in such a cruel way, in the sense of, like, you know, that they're sort of like, oh no, because it can't, that there can't simply be no answer for this. There's someone conspiring against us. There's there is a possibility, a very real possibility, in fact, absolute truth, that bad shit happens. And it's also quite quasi-religious principle about it.
Oh, absolutely. I completely understand. And we've actually dealt with this on the podcast before.
Sorry.
But this is the plug zone. And
yeah, so just to conclude, the reason I plug those conspiracy guys is that with an appearance like my own, and I'm sure something that Taz might have to deal with, and Johnny, on a regular basis, when you go up to someone, an average Joe, and say, oh, let's talk about a conspiracy, they usually return with, stop smoking a ganja. So I would really like someone else, perhaps you, Hal, to discuss these with, because I would like to argue for and against these conspiracies. I find them very interesting, and yeah. I think Zamira is tired of me chewing her ear off. So that is my plug.
My favourite thing about, like, the anti-conspiracy arguments is the cost. Cost gets prohibitive hugely quickly.
Like, especially with the moon landings and just being like, are you actually...
Plugs.
Anyway, Hal, what are you plugging?
I'm sorry, it's so altruistic. Not altruistic, it's self-serving of me. Is that...
Well, that's the idea of the plugs.
Yeah, sorry.
Do you confuse plug is. Altruism with self-serving?
I just did. Absolutely just did. Absolutely did that.
Aesthetic. That's
the Marcus Resorcist, bravo!
It's that at some point relatively soon, don't check now, I'm going to be launching a new site for my band, which is talanas.org. But to say that now, it's not even vague, it's not even there. At the moment, it links to our Bandcamp. But however, we are shortly going to be releasing a new EP, which I'm rather proud of, if not for the fact that I've forgotten how all of the songs on it sound. Genuinely.
Oh, good.
I actually don't have any recollection.
Good luck doing that shit live, then.
Well, we do one of them, at least. Okay, one of them I do know in and out because we do it live. The rest of them, I don't know how they sound, because it was long ago enough for me to, like, there's some songs.
Okay.
And I will absolutely own up to that, because the thing is, we have to come back, by the way, after an acoustic album that people went, what the... Dude, seriously, honestly, what the fuck are you doing? So we're like, should we go back? Should we do the death metal thing again? Please, for God's sake, do the death metal.
Where do you
thing
find
again.
This? Where will they find this soon?
Talanas.org.
Talanas.org.
Wicked. All right, okay, bitches, let me show you how to do this. I have a book. It's out on Amazon.
Yeah.
You can find it if you do a search in Amazon for Walking Out. If you want to do extra special search, it'd be Walking Out Taran Wilmore. That's Taran. Wilmore. If you want to find me on Facebook...
Don't do that to me, bro.
If you want to find me on Facebook, all which right. There's almost going to be something soon. Almost. Give me a second. But that's facebook.com/TaranWilmore.
Boss!
Johnny.
Hello! I suppose... Given the snail pace at which it is progressing, there might at some point in the future be an EP that you might want to go places and look for. The band is called This Living Hand. It's going to be released on iTunes, Spotify, and all the other things.
It's wonderful. It's really good.
How much of it have you actually heard?
I was here and you were playing it.
But we were all mashed.
Oh, I was concentrating and it was really good.
You are good at that.
as are you, all the endurers.
Anyway.
The endurance.
We've just got a way to release it. The artwork is being finalised. It'll be with you before the end of time. Thank you very much.
And there's nothing more I like than a Keats quote.
Yeah, thank you!
I know my Keats. Occasionally.
Oh, that sounded vaguely street.
The more popular things. Man them know them Keats.
I just right? like the remixes, yeah.
All right.
Man's not hot. Man's not hot.
None of that Fanny Braun stuff.
Yorkshire Moors.
Consumption!
I did have a plug, but I can't remember it. So, Steam Group.
Butt plug? Will that do?
Please, go look up our Steam group. If you want to come play with us, come find our Discord.
Please, seriously.
I'll put a link on our webpage this week.
If you ever find a squeaky bar plug, just send it to me.
Right.
And so, I get in contact and we'll sort it out.
We had an amazing moment on the Discord where we woke up Rickard last night, where he forgot to mute his phone and turn Discord off, and we woke him up in the middle
of
the night.
More importantly, you woke him up with a completely unimportant message.
Yeah, it was me literally going, evening.
Can I just say, it's completely unrelated, it's like, please stop using Facebook links to anything related to business, because it's going to, and in my prediction is in the next, let's say, year and a half, it will become like MySpace. So I've done as the best I can to make sure that there is a single link of like all the socials. We use Talanas banned because Talanas is some South American. But seriously, Facebook is about to do the same thing as MySpace for business. Really seriously, stop promoting your business on Facebook because it is not working.
Or at least, if you're going to promote it, have one single link that you're going to
that you can use, like we do, like Talanas Band is it works on Instagram, it works on Twitter, it works on everything like that. But however, honestly,
cover your bases.
It is not okay to continue having any professional investment whatsoever in Facebook.
So with that, I'm going to do our social media plugs.
They are. Yeah.
So, cue the music. Share and tell a friend is the only way we're going to get more listeners. The website is poptopicpodcast.com. Search Poptopic Podcast on all your social medias to find us. And then send your emails and Poptopic audio topics. We haven't had an audio topic in a while.
It's been a while.
Yeah, so emails at poptopicpodcast.com. Send in whatever recording you want. We'll play it. Rate and review us on iTunes and Stitcher if you fancy it. I'm going to say four stars.
It
seems like you've more considered it. And like the video if on YouTube, if that's how you prefer to listen to it. Oh shit, I need to do like 3 episodes up on YouTube. Shit. Anyway, Taron.
Oh yeah, quick thank you to Orangafruüp with 2 username out for the use of their song Trippples with 3 P's. Trippples with 3 P's can be found on the self-titled album named Orangafruüp with 2 username out. Yeah, go find them on Bandcamp and buy their shit. They deserve your money and wicked.
Absolutely. And thank you all the hosts for joining me this evening and audience now. Yeah, I'll get him flipped off from the audience. And of course, thank you all for listening, my endurers. Can we all give a resounding, if you're listening to this in the car or on your own, just give me a shout with you. Oboshi!
La Bamba.
Right, ready for silence? Everyone stay still. All I can hear is noise. Stop rolling a fag.
I did. That noise you could hear was Johnny Kimmy's not face. Quite slapping Kimmy's face. using our housemate as a percussion instrument.
Dude, you know you'd hit that. Right, anyway, silence.